Hey everybody, it's Scott Holden here. I want to take a moment to talk to you about an Indiegogo campaign that we started. Recently, we were sort of inspired, and right here on the show, we were inspired to do a documentary about podcasting. We started telling friends about it, and they became very enthusiastic and started lending their support. We quickly realized that this could be a real thing with friends like Bob Hawke, Dave Madison, Scott Chiaffo, Scott Meany, and Ben Gumry lending their support to this project. If you would like to lend your support to this project, please go to igg.me/AT/podcastmovie and help us out. You can also go to whatsapodcastmovie.com. We really appreciate your assistance. We hope you can help us out in any way you can. There's many perks. And we appreciate anything you can do, even if it's just pass the word on. Thank you.
This is Kevin Conroy, the voice of Batman, and I want to urge you to make a generous donation to the Wayne Foundation so we can stop the sexual trafficking of children. Do it, or I'll find you.
And don't forget to check out our good friend of the show, Mark Live, over at chundertunes.com for all your podcast animation needs. ThatMan on Fatman is recorded with a Zoom H6 handy recorder.
Zoom.
For creators.
Disclaimer! The show you're about to experience is for entertainment purposes only. The hosts use mature language and conversation just like in most of life. If you're too uptight, this might not be for you. All that said, we really do hope you enjoy the show. But if you don't enjoy it, expect a nice big shipment of my joyous Joker juice on your doorstep in the very near future. Toodles!
As the world's biggest Kevin Smith fan, I appreciate the fact that somebody finally made a podcast about that interesting motherfucker. So yes, you absolutely did the right thing. If I mean, you know, I know it's kind of gross for me to be like, yes, doing a Kevin Smith podcast fucking smart. Yeah. But I do feel like it was smart. I appreciate it. I think you were right to do that.
Okay. What has two thumbs and is a huge fan of Kevin Smith? That man!
What are we going to do about the pancake master?
We need a costumed vigilante is what we need. Justice can't be served unless it's being fought outside the system.
Here's what we're going to do, eh?
Oh, shit. It's that man. Who is he? He's that man. He's talking. What should we do?
Oh, there he goes by in the that mobile.
The what? That mobile. His car. Go get him, that man.
Well, once upon a time, a regular man read a book written by the Fat Man. Tough shit, written by old Kev Smith. Kev said go out and start a podcast, and so I did, and I had a real blast. But my obsession was driving my co-host nuts. Didn't want to bring the podcast down. Needed Porkchop Murphy to hang around. So I create a new show with one heck of a plan, and I call that show That Man on Fat Man, because we're going to chat about Kevin Smith. That's right, let's talk about old Kev Smith.
Hey everyone, and welcome to this episode 2-20 of That Man on Fat Man. I am Scott Holden. With me is Mike. Co-host, producer extraordinaire, Gene Holden.
Hey, everybody. It's funny because it changes each time.
Yeah. Well, I've kind of dropped the part-time because what's the relevancy?
Kind of like
I've grown up.
Jazz it up a little each time.
Okay. Well, there you go.
I like it.
She's also my wife and my friend, my best friend and all that stuff as well. So there you have it. Do you want me to tack all those?
All of those extraordinary things.
Titles? Okay. Well, welcome. This is the 20th show of what is our second year in of That Man on Fat Man. And we have a special episode cooked up. But before we get to any of that, there's been a ton of Kevin Smith news with Comic-Con and all kinds of stuff going on. So let's listen in to Indie Mac User as he provides us with this week's Smedlines.
Hello, this is Ben from the blog Indie Mac User with the Smed Lines Roundup for the 11th of July 2015. And we're bringing you a lot of news this week from the Smed Lines newsroom following Kevin Smith's Hall H panel at San Diego Comic-Con. There was a slight upset with Kevin's panel after the Star Wars panel, which preceded his, ended with J.J. Abrams inviting the whole audience to attend a free outdoor Star Wars concert. Although Kevin continued with his panel, and a die-hard selection of fans stayed on to watch. Kevin had previously released a photo of himself in the Bratzy costume from Yoga Hosers. This is a prosthetic costume from one of the villains from the film, described as a Canadian Nazi made of sentiment bratwurst. There were also images of several other villains in the film, which may also be played by Kevin, which you can find on Twitter. Kevin was joined on stage for the first time by his daughter, Harley Quinn, who also appears in Yoga Hosers and announced a trailer for the film, as well as joining Kevin for Q&A. It was also announced that she will play Brody's daughter in the upcoming film Mallrats. More news from San Diego Comic-Con. As part of the Walking Dead announcements from AMC, they announced that the air date for Comic Book Men's Season 5 would be October 18th. Also, I'd like to remind you that the Death of Superman Lives, What Happened documentary featuring Kevin Smith is now available online to order for Blu-ray, DVD, or download immediately, and I highly recommend that documentary. You can find that at tdoslwh.com. Also, some unrelated news from Comic-Con. You can find the Star Wars sizzle reel and the Star Wars panel in full on YouTube, and also you can find the new very awesome trailer for the TV show Ash vs. the Evil Dead on YouTube as well. That's the Smed Lines for this week.
And there's this week's Smed Lines.
There you go. I just puked that one up.
That's very, like, crazy.
Yes. Wacky morning zoo.
Wacky.
Thank you very much, Ben.
Zany. Zany voice.
For your contributions to the show this week.
Yeah. And in general.
Yes. Well, we all know.
Many, many things.
He's working his butt off over there for the movie. That is true.
He totally rocks.
And actually, just quickly, let me interject with some of the updates for What's a Podcast, the film that we're beginning to make. Actually, tomorrow we're going to actually roll some of our first footage. So, yes, we're very happy to welcome Jen Romaro. She's a comedian and she hosts Tap Out on Sirius XM every Thursdays, I believe.
Thursday, I think, 2 o'clock.
Also, we're happy to say that the Reverend Bob Levy from, some folks might know him from the Howard Stern Show, his pay-per-view stuff, or, you know, he's Last Comic Standing.
Yeah.
He's a pretty well-known comic, and we're very grateful to have him involved as well. Since we're talking about filmmaking and this project, let me just throw out the address. And if you notice, folks, as sort of a way to alleviate, you know, the promotion of this film so much, we pulled all the other commercials out until such time as the Indiegogo stops. And you can go to that Indiegogo campaign at the best way to go there is whatsapodcastmovie.com and follow the link to Indiegogo. You can also go to ThatMan on fatman.com and follow the link to Indiegogo. Or you can just go to the link from Indiegogo, which is igg.me/AT/podcastmovie. So there you go. Please go and contribute. We're slightly more than 1/15th of the way there now.
Thanks to everybody.
We're in the last third of the campaign. We're in 10 days and counting down. So depending on when you hear this is depending on where the campaign is at. But if you can get over there, please help us out.
And there's perks involved.
Yes, there's all kinds of perks. One being a podcast that will never be part of this feed, an exclusive bonus pod.
Just
and
you
can get
you.
In for that. Like, everybody gets that so long as you give $5
Five
or more.
Bucks, yeah.
And if you give more, you still get
you
that,
You still
too.
Get that. You get everything.
Yeah, it's the trickle down.
The
unless
trickle
they're
down,
limited.
Right.
Like, we have one, like, there's a $50 one that's limited.
Okay.
So, that if you got that one, you would get other perks beneath it that aren't limited.
Okay, which is probably the rest of them.
Yeah. So, okay, here's a good way to do it. Say you want the film perk, the one that where you get a screener.
Uh-huh.
$100
Okay.
You get you do get the screener, but you don't get your voice in the movie because that is an exclusive $50.
Oh, I see what you mean.
But okay. You will get the all bonus the, pod, the yeah. shout out on Twitter, right. all that stuff. So okay. everything it falls beneath.
So. When do you do the shout out on Twitter? Like
after the campaign closes and we figure out who gets what, then we solicit them and then we give them their formal tweets.
That's very cool.
Yes. Yes. So anyway, so look forward to all that. Sorry that we hog up a lot of time about the film. As you'll okay, so now we can talk about our guests because we have two guests this week, and it's so cool the way this came together. We originally recorded with Dr. Squee from the podcast Gallifrey Stands, also known as Brit at Brit Ant on Twitter.
Yes. He's gotten many.
Yeah, we met him way a while ago back on BCJ.
Yep.
And, he had an accent, and he's such a good guy, and he's very entertaining. He's a born podcaster. It's so funny because he's excelling at it. I listened to his show not too long ago. I was like, wow, he's gotten really good. So we were glad to have him on.
Mm-hmm.
And he's from England, and his show is based on Doctor Who, which I know almost next to nothing about. What I know about Doctor Who, I pretty much know from his show, which is not a whole heck of a
right.
lot. Just because of who I am. Anyway, but he does in our interview, amazingly, he does not talk about Doctor Who, and I don't talk about Kevin Smith.
Yeah.
We talk like politics and Queen. We end up talking a lot of Queen.
Queen, that's right.
Now, this is the weird thing. So awesome. Then, yesterday, I'm out on the interwebs, out on the Twitters, and I just see this one. Something caught my eye. It looked like Flash Gordon-y. And I said, what's this? And I opened up the tweet and I saw, support our project. We're doing they were doing a documentary on the film Flash Gordon.
That's so cool.
And anyone who has paid any attention to Bone Crushing Juggernaut and this show knows I'm a big fan of that movie. It's one of those childhood fanboy touchstones that
and you'll put it on once in a while.
I love it. I can always put it on. It'll always cheer me up. It's a good time. It's a fun watch. I'll throw it on maybe bi-monthly.
It's definitely something that I've gotten
more used to.
Yeah, I kind of get it now since I've seen it so many times.
Yeah, but and it's funny because we go into a lot of this, but so I reached out to this Twitter address upon seeing it immediately. And I was like, they're doing an Indiegogo campaign. They're doing a documentary. And I was like, I reached out immediately and said, I got to have you on the program. I got to have you on my show. And she got back very quickly. And yes, I said she, which was the first shock.
Isn't that awesome?
Yeah. I just did not expect that. I know it's kind of sexist or misogynistic, but that movie's so associated with boyhood in my mind that a girl would want to pay homage to that film.
And a very cute, sweet girl. I mean.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That very, very much so. And I didn't even watch her Indiegogo campaign pitch video until after we talked. I mean, that's how rapid this thing mm-hmm. was coming together. Because I was working and tweeting and doing other stuff. So I didn't get to watch it. But so in our second interview, we discuss this movie that she's making. Did I say her name yet? I don't think I did. It's Lisa Downs.
Lisa Downs.
Lisa Downs. And the Twitter account is at Life After Flash. And just if you Google it or if you go to their IGG.
It's a really cool logo too.
Yeah, their Indiegogo campaign. You can check that out. Go to Indiegogo, type in Life After Flash.
And the video is awesome for that.
Yes. Or while you're there, you can always type in what's a podcast too.
She's very supportive of us.
Yeah. Cool. Again, in this conversation, that interview came together very quickly. And we kind of fanboy out. And of course, we talk about Queen again. So,
yeah,
because you can't talk about Flash. Oh, God, I fucking blow a gut because she reveals that she may be meeting with members. For the
Queen?
Yeah. And I'm like, oh! And I tell her to, I give her a message for Brian May, like it matters. Like,
you know,
here's some stranger that you don't know.
What did you say?
Well, you'll hear it. You'll hear it. She has, yeah, she heard half the interview last night.
Yeah.
Didn't hear the whole thing. We were doing other stuff. But yeah, I love both these interviews. They're both very fun. They're both very British, hence the British Invasion. They're both very sci-fi. They're not as Kevin Smith, but one is about filmmaking, and the other is a podcaster who was inspired to podcast via Kevin Smith, and now a friend of the show, and will also be in the documentary as well. Mm-hmm. And Ben is handling that side, so. Yeah, so all this ties back to movie-making extravaganza. Everybody's sick of hearing about it. I know. We talk about that, too, Lisa and I.
So, okay.
Yeah, like about how awkward it is to have an Indiegogo campaign and to become, oh, my God, I'm that guy. Mm. I'm not annoying Indiegogo guy. Ah. Yeah, but we have to do what we got to do.
Yeah, we kind of have to get over it because we're doing
shit's happening.
It. Yeah.
But that's in the second part of the interview block that we're about to present. Mm. This is going to be a long show, folks. We may even go 3 hours on this one. I don't even know. But in our first interview block, we have Dr. Squee from Gallifrey Stands.
Yes. That was fun.
I think Dottie Who even checks in at one point for the Dottie Who fans out there. And here we go. We just kind of geek out and have a great conversation. Again, please listen to a show if you're a Whovian. Here we go. Dr. Squee.
One man in America, one man in the UK.
Darn, I wish I was rolling because I just stopped because I was going to reset to come back in. So we missed all that gold about the pool.
I don't know how much it was gold, but we can recapture it.
Well, yeah. Anyway, we're joined, as you hear, mid-conversation by a good friend of the show, someone I have a lot of respect for as a podcaster who's grown and like as... sounds professional as fuck when you listen to his show. He hosts Gallifrey Stands. You may know him also as Brit Ant from Twitter. So everybody, this is Dr. Squee from Gallifrey Stands. Welcome to the show.
Hello, sir.
And hey, I like having you on, not necessarily to talk Doctor Who, because as many people may know, I'm Who illiterate. My Who knowledge is very small. But I just, you know, I know you're a fellow, you know, fan of all, you know, the Kevin Smith stuff, and you have an ant handle out there as well, so that's a Tell Him Steve Dave thing, and, you know, so, and last time you were on, we had good political discussion, which I enjoyed, and especially in light of yesterday, heck.
Oh, yeah,
you know,
yeah.
What good day to talk, and I'm glad to have you on the show. Welcome, the host of Gallifrey Stands, again.
Yeah, I mean, thank you for that wonderful intro. You know, it's funny you should say I've grown, because that's what my listeners do all the time, my awful puns, so it's appropriate.
Well, no, I mean, listening, again, I'm not a Whovian, but I do listen to your podcast. I do more checking in. You know, I'm not, like, I'll admit, I'm not every episode, but I do check in frequently. And I like your intros and your outros and that kind of thing. But I tell you, I loved your anniversary show. That, to me, said, you know, in the year that you were podcasting, it was like, God, this guy's become a pro. And I will say, I'm going to steal that idea next year. I tipped my hat to you to be interviewed on your own show for that anniversary. That I get it. It made a lot of sense as to why to do it. You're more comfortable.
I think the other way, the only, you know, the reason why I chose to do that and the reason why I think it works so well is that otherwise there's just too much pressure to try and include everything.
Yeah.
And I loved your, I actually loved your anniversary show, but I felt you had the same pressure that feeling going into that of wanting to kind of include everyone, include every clip, including, you know, just try to get everything in there. Whereas if you hand it to someone else, then they'll bring the stuff that they enjoyed the most, and hopefully that include most people, and you try and get everything in still, but it takes a bit of an edge off it.
Yeah, and there's a different, as someone who's been on other people's podcasts, there is a different feeling when you're on someone else's show. It's much more relaxed, because all you have to do is answer questions and or talk about yourself, which is pretty easy.
Yeah, I was really looking forward to this show today, just because not only is that very enjoyable just to be the guest, and it's like there's no pressure of setup and all that stuff, but also it's the fact that, well, for me, it's also the fact that my show's about Doctor Who, which I love, and I can talk talk about Doctor Who till the cows come home, but it's really nice to do someone else's show so you can branch off into some different stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
I've done some shows where I've been the guest and they just want to talk more Who, and I was like, well, let's do that on my show. Let's just talk about some other stuff now. Let's have some fun.
I've been finding my... I think it's even leaking out onto the shows now, because it's not like I'm at it. Like, now that BCJ is sort of back in effect, I'm kind of compartmentalizing. You know, people say, do you want this person on? And I'll be like, yeah, but they'll be good guests for Bone Crush and Juggernaut, really, because there we can talk about that unfettered.
Oh, yeah, how's BCJ going now?
It's coming back. You know, it's settling itself back in, but... So.
Oh, excellent. I haven't actually listened to it since it's come back. I didn't realize it was back on at the moment. So Joe's back in the fold as well.
Yep. 2 weeks. We've done two episodes, and now we've just said we're doing bi-weekly, takes all the pressure off for that show. It can be the weird incubator that it is, you know.
Well, and I'll tell you what, the other thing is that if you listen to Netheads, when it went through that period where... Trent had to take a break for a bit because of everything that was going on for him. When they came back, it was better than ever. I think it really is it was a revival of that show in a number of ways. So, you know, you might find the same. Maybe it just gives you a bit more of a fresh angle at it. Maybe you've had a break and it just, you can come at it reinvigorated again.
Yeah.
So that's really cool.
I'm glad it's back, because that's my outlet for anything not Kevin Smith. Again, love this show, love everything we do. But like you said, like going on other shows and like, you know, doing other podcasts, it's great to break out of your normal theme.
Oh, and while we're on that very thread, just while I remember it, because I was determined I'd give a shout to it, if you don't mind.
No,
I actually did a crossover myself.
Okay.
So by the time this goes out, that show should have gone out, because I did a crossover one myself with the Just Give Me a Few Minutes podcast. That's Mike M, who's one of the ants.
Okay.
So please everyone check that out and go for, because we talked Kevin Smith for a good chunk of that. I think that was on my show. And then it was quite funny, actually. We ended up talking more Kevin Smith on my show and then more Doctor Who on his. So we got it totally arse backwards, but give it a listen.
Where is he based out of? Is he UK? US? Is he?
He's in US.
Okay.
And I believe he's around New Jersey somewhere.
Cool.
If I'm correct. But I remember the one thing I can remember is he was going to Albuquerque that day to go to Bacon Fest.
Oh, cool.
And we discovered there was two Albuquerques over there. But I was just enthralled by the idea of Bacon Fest to the degree where I forgot everything else he was saying about where he's from.
I can believe that, because, you know, what's not to like about bacon?
Oh, man, it just made me think of one of my new favorite shows now is the Epic Meal Empire. Kev Smith was in one of the episodes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and of course, Harley was in one of the was in Tusk, of course.
Yes, of course, he is the border guard.
I want to talk to you about Tusk if you get him.
Yeah, I would love to talk about Tusk too, because here's something I would like to say. Here's what I'm sensing already on the internet and from people I talk to. People are starting to love that movie.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That is visible. People are like, and it's great because. They're young people.
I think the genius of that one was that because Kev is now just appealing to his base, he's not worried about the people who aren't into him. If they like it, cool. But at the end of the day, he's appealing to his fans.
Yes.
And I think straight away, the people who it was meant for did get it. It's, you know,
yes.
There wasn't that usual thing with Kevin's films that it takes 20 years to build its audience.
Can I tell
it
you this?
Its audience baked in.
I know some people who are, you know, in the circle who did not have that reaction. You know what I mean? And who you would figure would get the joke because they're friends or associates. But not everyone loved that one.
Well, yeah, I agree. But I think there is that thing as well as him appealing to the base, because he made a kind of wacky movie.
Exactly.
Which would appeal to people who are into his stuff. At the same time, it was a departure as well. I know that sounds a bit of a contradictory statement, but I think it was something different, but kind of in his wacky world as well. And I think that would lose a few of his fans. But I think it also brought in a few people who are into horror who wouldn't be into his stuff usually.
Oh, yeah,
so it's
definitely.
Kind of like you lost on one hand, you gained on the other. But I don't think it needed that, 10 or 20 years that some of Kev's films
following. This is the theme Gene and I have been talking about in wraparounds and on episodes. Thank you, internet.
hey, gay marriage just passed here. It's the law of the land in the United States. Woo. Thank you, Internet. I know a lot of people did a lot of work. Gene's here. She's like chomping at the bit, ready to jump in.
Yay. Hallelujah. Yes. Today is a great day for America.
You know, but again, thank you, Internet. Social change happens really quickly now. Thank you, Internet.
Well, yeah, I mean, I was actually enjoying some man-on-man action on this podcast until Gene ruined the sausage fest we had going on.
I know.
Yes, yes, well, indeed.
It's a threesome now. People yes. like that.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong Ooh. With that. As Woody Allen said, when you're bisexual, it automatically doubles your chances for dates.
So, there you go.
There you go. It is a beautiful thing, though. It's you just...
Actually, my attitude is like, it doubles your chance for rejection as well.
Well, that's true. But, I mean, it happened yesterday. But even, like, you wake up today. I did, anyway.
The bisexual glass can be half empty as well.
This is, like, we're in a historical time right now around in America.
Yes. Finally.
Yep. It's all going to be in the textbooks or whatever they use. They won't use textbooks, probably. In the future.
And even in this wonderful moment, though, when you've got everyone coming together, everyone celebrating this wonderful landmark moment.
Right.
There
you've already
shitters.
Got Bobby Jindal on the right trying to stop it in his state. So that's lovely.
It really is.
Not exactly sure how he can do that now.
Well, he's trying to claim... Now, following his logic is a work in itself. But he's now saying because there's a case going through the lower courts, not the Supreme Court, he's going to follow that one through and wait until that's decided before he decides what he's going to do, even though it's the Supreme Court, which Supreme's kind of baked into the title.
You understand what can happen now. You could actually deploy federal troops to make him do it. That's the difference. Yes.
Who's him, though?
To make whoever, someone who's an obstructionist. That's why it was important with civil rights. This is what it all comes down to. People saying that I didn't get to vote for those rights for those people.
But you don't.
Well, you don't vote for rights for people.
Exactly.
If people voted for rights for people, I get these rights, but they don't.
Exactly.
So that's... And then
that's what Chris Christie
The role
said.
Of government is to defend the minority from the crazy majority.
And also, let's make this clear. It's not the majority. That's the thing. The majority now are in favor of gay marriage. That's why this kind of took on such a momentum.
Absolutely.
Because so many people switched to the right side of history on this one. And
Agreed.
It's not the majority anymore. It's the creepy right wing who just want to kind of get everything back to the good old days when everyone was oppressed. It's,
yes.
You know,
yes. White on top.
White on top.
Yes.
Yeah.
White
straight
Well,
men.
No. White straight appearing men.
Yeah. Appearing.
Because let's face it.
Yeah.
Yeah, plenty of those white straight men. The reason they have
Scott.
Such a hard on for homosexuality.
Let
is,
me just say this:
you know,
there's a
I,
lot.
Methinks thou doth protest too much.
And let me tell you this:
me and Scott are sick and tired of white straight men who like the sound of their own voices. Isn't that right, Scott? Let's talk about
exactly.
it.
Exactly. Isn't that ironic?
It's so true.
Aspects of that are settled in the United States, as they were in Britain for how long? How long has it been legal there?
Oh, I have no idea. I mean, it actually, bizarrely enough, has happened underneath a conservative government, which just amazed everyone. I think it's only been a few years now, maybe 1 or 2 years.
Yeah, but still, way ahead of us. And you guys almost quietly. I mean, it was just like, I don't remember the same sort of fanfare and everything. It was just sort of matter of fact.
Well, because it should be a matter of fact.
I agree.
That's the way it should be.
But it's still...
Yeah, that was the amazing thing, though. You are right that it just kind of... basically, it was announced, and there was a lot of celebration on, that week, and then we just went by with it.
Yeah.
And that was the amazing thing. And I think you're completely right. It should just be... Of course it is. Of course that's legal. Of course... Legal? That's ridiculous. You should be talking about law.
Yes, yeah, we're talking about rights. We're not talking about anything...
It's the level of the discussion which it's got to in America, whereby, one minute the right is saying that we should go with what, the majority want, and then when the majority go against them, then it's, we should, be able to just say what we want due to religion, not due to what everyone else wants. And then when religion doesn't go against them, doesn't go with them, like the Pope said stuff, against
God,
what
the
they
Pope.
Want
then
with global
wrong.
Warming, then suddenly it should be, you're not a scientist.
Which he is, actually, when you do the Pope's background. He has a science background.
And he is a brilliant man, and he is changing.
He was a chemist.
He's changing things. He's changing people's minds. Oh, he's pissing people off, too.
Well,
and this is a religion which believes that he's infallible until they disagree with him. Then they suddenly go back on
that. Absolutely
right. And that's why
I
can't understand.
Religion's a whole other bailiwick
to
start to unravel.
But if
they're
going to say that's what they're going by, that's the rule books which they're going by, is their religion, then the second their religion disagrees with them, they can't suddenly say it's like, well, no, but not that part of it.
Again.
That's the problem.
It goes back to, there's this free communication going on that this 20th century thinking right just sort of wants to dismiss and not acknowledge or hasn't figured out how to use. But all they're doing is sort of marginalizing themselves as the rest of us have access to information now. Oh, right. You mean I can just go in here and see that point is wrong? Or here's 500 contradictions on The Daily Show. Or, right. Whatever. It's starting to free up. Things are changing.
Right. I can
though the mainstream media doesn't acknowledge any of this.
I can find facts to back up my point and to...
Yes. Show that you are silly.
Show that you're full of shit and a piece of crap.
And again, it goes back to this. You can't build a mountain on a pile of shit. It'll always be shitty. You can't start on a negative. You can't start on, I want to deny people something. Mm. I want, because I find it uncomfortable. It makes me feel icky. You can't do that. That's not your. And then the religious people, what I didn't get was, okay, now you have these Christians who are using Christianity to defend why they can deny services to people because they're gay. So my argument to that is, if they're allowed to do that, what's the difference than them going, I'm going to deny services to you because you're Jewish, which is a religion that's not mine. I don't share its values.
Do you know Dan Savage? He's a podcaster himself and a gay rights activist.
Yes.
He said that, it's fine. They should be allowed to discriminate against gay people and not bake their cake. But they have to put a sign in the window saying all the people they won't serve to. And then let's see how long they stay in business.
True.
Yes, okay, all the gay people, all the blacks, everyone, we will stop shopping there, and good luck to you.
Yes.
And we'll go to
the
cake shop, which will serve everyone.
How do they know the person's gay?
Their argument was, they always went back to this cake sales as their argument.
Oh, okay, so it was like you're openly saying, I'm marrying a man or I'm marrying a woman.
Yes, and that...
Okay. Yeah.
So, but if you're allowed to, if someone's allowed to do that, why aren't they allowed to say, well... it's a Jewish wedding? Well, I'm sorry, I don't serve Jews.
They probably can do that too, and that's total discrimination.
And that is horrible, exactly. So why can't you draw that quick parallel and say, this whole argument is fucking ass backwards.
Right.
We want the right to discriminate.
I was just going to say, there's also the argument which is made that people can vote with their wallet, but then as soon as when something like this story comes out and people start putting it online and it gets into a big discussion, and then when sponsors, for instance, on TV shows withdraw their sponsorship because of what happened with Duck Dynasty or with 19 Kids and Counting, then suddenly the right say it's like, oh, well, people getting fired for this, or people withdrawing their money, or the networks fired them. Well, yes, that's them voting, though, as well. Surely the network's got a right as well to say, well, if people aren't going to watch because of this, we're not going to show it.
Yes.
So, but as soon as then it gets to that level, then they suddenly disagree with that. Then it's like, you can't do that. But isn't that the network voting with their wallet? The sponsors voting with their wallet?
Well, the truth of the matter is, that's a private company. It can do whatever the heck it wants. It's in its best interest to please the consumers, but, it doesn't have to. It is what Chomsky called a divine tyranny. It gets to do what it wants.
Beyond. I was going to say, you floored me with Chomsky there. I have no answer to Chomsky.
Chomsky, yeah, exactly. It's like, oh, fuck.
Like, what do you say after that?
It's true. I mean, when it's the old... we could go back to the old myth that previously, before the internet, the media was as free and as liberal as the conservative corporations that owned them.
This is a very passionate subject.
Yes.
So when you get three people like us together, it becomes, a very intense conversation.
Yes. And we'll need a lot of editing.
Yes. It's a very freeing thing.
Yes.
And people should be free. This is America.
Yes.
People are getting married right now. Okay.
But we actually drove by a celebration when we were
We drove to a friend's house last night, and they were out, like, in front of the municipal building. And I'm like, what's going on? And it didn't hit me right away. But then you see, like, equality, like, big signs.
Yeah, I guess
signs.
People were getting married. But here was the weird – I was like, but Jersey's had this. But I guess, everyone's caught up in the spirit.
But it was such a beautiful thing. Like, these people are just, like, congregating in front of this building, like, on the grass and having
a lot of smiles,
food and smiles and like partying outside. It was such a beautiful thing.
Well, I'll tell you, I mean, I've never actually been to a gay wedding yet. I've got my first one coming up, which is actually going to be, it wraps into the show very nicely because it's Ben Lewis from Indie Mac.
Oh, I'm jealous.
Oh, yes,
so
I
want to
go. When is that?
And the thing is, I know gay weddings can, as much as straight weddings, be like anything from a kind of quiet somber affair to a big party and everything. But I'm really hoping, because I just want to go to one big fat gay wedding, like one really absurdly
I want to go,
and I think Lewis could do
it. I was going to say, I don't know a lot about Lewis, but from the small chats and from my little exposure I've had, I could see him doing that.
So Lewis, it's down to you. Like, I know Ben will be a bit more reserved and quiet, but I think he'd go along with it. So Lewis, come on, make it big.
Oh, make it big. And when is it? When is it?
Forget that. Make it gay. Make it gay.
Make it gay. I want to come so bad. That's I'm so jealous. You have to periscope while you're there so we can see it. Oh, I'm so jealous.
But as opposed to the smed lines, we could have the wed lines.
Right. The wed lines. Yeah. I love it.
Well, definitely not for nothing. He's the second unit director. He's working with us on the film project now. And I couldn't be happier about that because if I haven't mentioned it on the show yet, it's like such a weight off my mind. Because originally UK, in terms of that film, was like third priority. We'll get to this if we can.
Right.
But as soon as we had him on, he's so enthusiastic, so on top of things. It's now truly a parallel operation. So
yeah, I mean, in this last week, we've been forwarding a lot of things about that because just bouncing ideas off me, and plus I'm going to be a part of the pot with the documentary, which I'm very much looking forward to. So sort of scheduling when I'd be coming up to meet him once he's got a schedule in place and all that kind of stuff. So it's I can just tell how excited Ben is about it and how he kind of he's going like, I have no idea where I'm going to fit in all the time to do this, but I'm very excited and it'll be cool, you know. So
right now, as I said, he's my left arm. I'm a lefty. He's my left arm there, so...
Wow, that says a lot.
He has second unit director. He's the kind of free reign. He knows what we're going for. And
well, you know, and the trust is there. So,
yeah,
I mean,
definitely.
You 100% trust his
Ben
opinions,
and I have
his...
grown close over the last
you have.
Or whatever. Yeah, he's a confidant and he's a pal, so...
He is.
And I'll tell you what, if he's your left arm, I've been kind of like your pinky. I've been working with him. I'm trying to help him out.
Yeah, he's a...
And you are a welcome addition too. So we're very happy.
Oh yeah, we're very glad you're participating. Right out of the box, Doctor Who is something that needs to be. I mean, that's its own genre. So to have you on board to represent that is great for the film.
Yeah, and he's been just me and Ben have been talking. He's been asking me about people who kind of I might have coming up to interview. And I've had a few ideas about kind of a few left field people, because the good thing is sometimes when you've got a topic like Doctor Who, which is obviously a specific thing, you can go a bit left field and get someone who's kind of like linked to the world, but not like I had a comedian on a while ago called Richard Herring, who's sort of known as a cult comedian over here, but you know, wouldn't be known in America at all. But he does loads of stand up. He's not a Whovian, but he's used Doctor Who in his stand up so many times and done so many routines where he references it, and he was in an audio play for Doctor Who and all this kind of stuff. So I managed to get a half hour kind of interview with him, but he would be, I don't think anyone apart from me would have ever thought of getting him on the show. So so I've been discussing a few ideas and a few names like that to get someone a bit different, as well as someone a bit more Who-centric.
Yeah I mean, Ben sort of has the running plan or the orders. We obviously in an undertaking like this, you want as much as you can get. You want as broad as you can get. You want diversity. But yeah, an innovation is definitely, or people who are fringe, or, you know, you're not, are they pushing the border, or what are they doing over here? That's definitely stuff we want to look at for sure. So yeah, and the fact that now we have a link in to the UK, so much easier, someone sort of organizing all that for us, is such a big help. So,
and I'd just like to say, while we're on the subject of Ben and Lewis, they've been absolutely fantastic supporting my podcast as well, Gallifrey Stands. They're a great couple of guys. And so anyone who hasn't yet, and why wouldn't you, go to the Indie Mac user blog. It's got Horror Month still happening at the moment. It's just in its dying days of that. Actually, by the time this comes out, it won't be. But go and check out all the stuff from their Horror Month. It was fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
And check out what they're doing now, because they're just great.
Thanks.
We love him.
Yeah,
we love them.
Yeah, they're I agree. Taking a sip here. Hang on.
And I have to meet them.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, when I met them up in Wales, they were lovely as well.
Oh my god, I loved
seeing all those pictures.
Oh my god,
and
I loved seeing those pictures. It's so great.
And there you go. Another speaking to the joys of social media and all this stuff. People sort of feel connected to we've never actually all met physically, but
and they feel drawn to one another to meet one another.
Yeah,
like that's so cool.
Yeah.
In one weekend, I met Ben and Lewis, and there was someone called Estefania from America, and someone
I know
called,
that name.
Mel from she's well, she, well, you would have seen her on Twitter.
Yeah,
probably.
Yeah.
And also there was Mel Dwyer, and like all these people happened to be in Wales in the same weekend. We kind of slightly engineered it so we'd overlap. They all happened to be coming over at the same time, so we got five of us meeting up from three different countries, four if you count Wales. And it was, great.
And you've had Jacinda on like a whole bunch of times. I'm jealous because we keep, every time we keep going to get her, like something happens.
Yeah, she's coming on now.
Jacinda's fantastic. Good luck.
The recorder's rolling again.
Okay, well, look, we mentioned Tusk before. Something I wanted to get onto, seeing as you're doing the documentary about podcasters.
Yes.
And it's an interesting point I've been meaning to have a chat with someone about, so it seemed like a good opportunity. You know the podcast they do within Tusk?
Yeah.
I thought it was a really interesting choice, and I don't know if this was a conscious idea by him or not, but the fact that Kev chose to do a podcast, which is not only very different from the style of podcasting he does, because it felt more like a sort of Morning Zoo style show that they were doing, and a bit more like, woo, and doing wacky voices and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
But I thought it was interesting that if you watch it, if that was a podcast, I think they wouldn't actually be that great at podcasters. And I thought that was an interesting kind of choice. What did you think of that?
If I wanted to get that literal with it, they do feel like they could talk together, those two guys, Wally and, what's the other guy's name?
I see dead people.
Yeah, I know that's him and his famous line, but what the hell's the name of his character in the movie? Shoot, no, I can't think of it. Because it's right out of the character from, it comes right out of the podcast.
I know.
Because that was the Scott Mosier character, if you go back to
I can't think now.
Yeah, it'll come to us as we.
But those two guys anyway.
Wallace and
I believe that they were podcast. Here's what I loved about all of that. That movie, for better or worse, which is now on Netflix, one of the most powerful, movie making mediums, right?
Teddy is his name.
Oh, Teddy, that's right, Teddy. Yes, Wallace and Teddy. You go all the way back from Brighton. Yeah, they jive together as podcasters, but the fact that podcasting is the central occupation to the story,
yes,
it's the motivation that sends him out into the world of crazy in Canada.
Right.
I mean, that is, to me, it's a boost for the medium, I mean, it helps things. And now we have Mark Maron with the president. That's another boost for the medium. So
that was amazing. Did you listen?
Oh my god!
Yeah. It's a great interview.
Wasn't it amazing?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a great show. I loved it.
Yeah, I thought the president, the amount of shit which they try and give him for saying anything, if he makes any statement which means anything, using the N-word on there, I thought it was so powerful and such an important message they put out.
The difference between the mediums, too, because listen to that interview with Mark Maron. You get to hear him so candid because it's a podcast.
Right, and
because
you can.
It's a different. There's no commercials to cut in or worry about. You get a person relaxed and just kind of talking. And that's the only.
And he asks him, he's like, "What? Yeah, are you nervous?" He's like, "Why would I be nervous?"
Yeah, and he says the word, the president says the word podcast on the podcast. I fucking cringe. I kind of got the chills when he said it. Like, we're legitimate. We've arrived. The president has used the fucking term.
And I think the big thing was that the president, he got it straight away. He'd obviously listened to the show in advance.
He knew
he obviously got what podcasting was. I think some of these politicians go on there and they expect the same kind of interviews they might get on TV, and they get shocked when it isn't, and they still don't react as if it's a more casual, more conversational medium.
Honest medium where we don't want to talk about your bullet points, or you may be asked about them after you actually spill out a bunch of bullshit.
Exactly, and Obama got that. He knew what he was getting in for. He knew probably in advance what he did and didn't want to talk about. So they're probably was some kind of like red flag somewhere else, he wouldn't go into.
Oh, I'm sure. But there's actually.
But he knew they'd have to reach out. He knew he'd have to be a bit more open, which I think he's already a very open man. But I think he knew he would have to be more open in his approach to that, and he got it.
There's an article I saw this morning, but have not read yet, and I flagged it. It's the story of how Marc Maron got the president to be on the podcast.
Really?
Yeah. So that's out now. I haven't read it yet, so I'm curious to find out how that worked out.
Well, if you listen to, I haven't listened to it yet, but there is a second show which Mark's done as a follow-up to the Obama interview where he talks about it for an hour. So I'm really looking forward to that. So I think it probably gives the same story. So I'm really looking forward to hearing what that journey was.
To see him finally...
Wow.
After his Air America had a lot of shit with him, they canceled him, they kind of threw him out. And
Marc Maron has the president, and Malcolm meets the president.
Yeah,
come on.
Wow, things are shifting.
Crazy.
Cray cray.
Cray cray. Yeah. That's your new thing, cray.
Well, I'm watching a lot of Larry Wilmore. The
Say what?
Yeah. It's a great show.
I dipped into the nightly myself.
Isn't
it's
it great?
Such a great show.
Isn't it great?
It is amazing. Look. If anyone told me that I would like the successor to Colbert so quickly, so much, like to the point where I think it's as good, if not better. And what an important show as well.
Yeah.
There is no show like it which engages not just the black community, it engages the whole community of America. But it does it whilst highlighting mostly African-American panelists.
The fact that
that's so important.
I described it, I've said on this show, I love the fact that, and this is such a weird, I shouldn't have to say this, but I love the fact that it's unapologetically black.
But at the same time, it's also inclusive. That
yes.
He could have done a show which just appeals to black viewers, and that would have been fine. There's nothing, I've got nothing against that. I'm just saying that what he did, I think, is so much more important because it engages everyone about the black issues.
Can
I tell
you
something? Forces everyone to take notice and to do it in a way that people don't feel threatened, I don't think.
It's as simple as if you get the Daily Show, you'll get it. You know?
Oh, on the Daily Show. Don't bring that up. It makes me so sad that Jon Stewart's leaving. No.
Oh, yeah. With that, also, with the Daily Show.
Yeah.
What do you think about the fact they've kind of replaced all of the correspondents? I kind of get how they do that in advance of a new host.
Oh, yeah.
But it kind of, I miss some of the kind of like old standards of the show. It's just on a personal level. I love some of the new correspondents, especially Jessica Williams, I think is fantastic.
Oh, yeah. I think everybody loves her. We got to see her live with, can't think of his name right now, the young guy who they just freaking hired. Well,
the name's slipping my mind now as well.
They did the Daily Show without Jon Stewart at New York City Podfest. They did it the night before our slot. So we went and saw him, and it was cool.
Is that Hassan guy?
It might be Hassan. Yes. Hassan
Minhaj.
Yeah, and he was very funny, too. He tells the story about getting hired.
You know who I really like is John Hodgman. Is that the guy, the really nerdy guy?
John Hodgman's awesome.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
He's
so
very
funny.
Quirky.
And you know what? I didn't
As
like
Kevin
him.
Would say.
It's like waves.
He makes some very interesting choices. Yes.
Yeah, it's like waves for me. Like, he's really funny, and then he's, like, really not. Like But of late, he's just been really, really, really funny. I like him a lot.
Yeah, he's very quirky.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. With the mustache.
Yeah. With the mustache makes me. I don't know what he's trying to get. Like, is he supposed to be funny? There's something funny about the mustache.
Yeah, he's just quirky. He's a quirky guy.
But to me, like, is it supposed to be attractive? Like, when he looks at it?
You know what I think it is? I think he's just trying to break that I'm a PC guy.
That's true.
And the mustache really does that.
Oh, my God.
It makes people, it generally makes people look more sinister. Or
it
more
does
gay.
Add, like,
or more gay. I'm sorry.
Why are you
on the podcast talking about his mustache? I think he just loves that mustache. That man likes his mustache.
He does.
I there's probably other reasons why he grew it, but like you wouldn't keep it for this many. Like it's been a few years now.
He's had it for a while.
Wait. Since we've opened this door of the mustache, I just want to have a little discussion about it because my feeling has always been, I mean, ever since Freddie Mercury, let's face it.
I just thought of that when you said
the mustache has always been very, I don't know, a gay sort of look.
Symbol? But look at Tom Selleck.
Okay,
he was
now,
not gay.
Now hear me out. Hear me through in this argument. Because usually in military or service type roles, at least in America, the only acceptable facial hair at all, if allowed, is usually just the mustache.
You can have a mustache? I didn't
think
you
could. Usually police will have them. or you know, military guys. I don't know, you know what level, but they'll have them. And most of them grow them for this cockamamie reason of, well, I can. This is the only thing I'm allowed to grow, so I'll grow this.
Mm, see, but like a cop with a mustache could be kind of hot, though.
I agree. But, I agree. In a very, you know, like YMCA sort of way, you know, young man. So what I'm saying, do you think they're aware of that? I guess as I'm going, that was a long story to get to. Do you think straight men with mustaches are aware of the strong gay vibe?
See, I just don't know if all people feel that gay vibe when they see a mustache.
Ah, you see, I've got a theory. I think that you have to look at some history here, because I think it's the fact that the mustache used to be worn by men in power. If you look in the history books, it's not men who are openly gay, it's men who are in power who like have these kind of big, thick, virile looking mustaches.
Yes, and
I think
chops.
It's the same thing as when you had black people playing blues clubs and stuff, and they wore suits and pork pie hats like you see the Blues Brothers wearing, because they knew that was the way of being accepted by establishment. And I think it's the same thing with a mustache. I think it's now seen as maybe more of a gay symbol, but I think it was gay men wearing that to perhaps like to cover, to be seen as like being more manly and not be questioned as much.
Really though? Because if, like, and I know, again, we're looking at stereotypical stuff here, but like, okay.
And these are all opinions.
But
think of the 70s sort of gay revolution, you know, the gay guy with the leather hat, the chaps, the, you know, the mustache. I mean, it just
Then you have Tom Selleck.
The cowboy. Who was the manliest man at that time. Hang on, what was that?
A few decades or even centuries before that, and you see men in power with mustaches, with like these big, like waxed mustaches, and with these big, like boon mustaches.
Yeah.
Facial hair was seen as a sign of virility for men. And I think that's
and vanity.
Where that came from. So I think it may have changed over time, but because people used it as something to be more accepted, maybe, and to be seen as more manly when gay people were seen as effeminate, maybe that was their way of being seen as more manly.
Yeah.
And I would just like to interject that this is why I love to have previous guests on, because...
You know, you can ramp on the mustaches for a little while longer if you want, but one thing I want to get to before we go is talk salad and scrambled eggs. I want to get on that.
Yes. All right. All right. Well, you know what? It's a good time to pivot. I'm done with mustaches. It was a non-sequitur anyway. The main question was, do straight men in a role of that kind of thing who choose to wear that mustache, do they know that it does sort of gay them up? I don't know.
Gay them up.
Or maybe they're just more comfortable and they don't.
And that's true, too. Hey, if they're, and maybe they are all comfortable in their own masculinity.
The thing was, when I saw, like, when I was growing up and I'd see Freddie Mercury's mustache, and you see Freddie Mercury on stage, and, like, if he wasn't doing one of the videos where he's dressed in drag or whatever else, if you saw him on stage and you saw him there with his mustache and the microphone in his hand, and he, for me, I thought he looked really kind of manly. Like, as a kid, I never questioned that it's a gay symbol.
It's funny, then you grow up, and, like, I recently, I mean, I'm a big Queen fan, but the best way to explain why I'm such a great big Queen fan, the first record that my parents, you know, they got me the record player, which I still remember, which had this like weird, like jeans pattern, like pockets sort of thing look on it, but it was just contact paper on it.
Yeah.
You open that sucker
up. '70s.
Yep. And the first record, it was a 45, Bohemian Rhapsody on one side, You're My Best Friend on the second.
Yeah.
And that was the first record that I, as a kid, ever received, and I play. And then in that same collection, my parents bought me a shitload of really cool 45s. I wonder what the heck happened to them. Yeah. They were cool once for a fleeting moment.
But you know what? If you do see him, like, because what's that one that we watch all the time? The live show.
Well, there's a couple, but yeah,
he has these white, like, he's
my perception.
Very flamboyant.
Yeah, things have changed. Like when he's running around in like a freaking yellow codpiece, you
know, he holds on to that microphone stand.
He holds himself on stage, and when he's singing something like "We Will Rock You," and he just looks so powerful.
He's
and
so
like,
confident.
There's nothing else but masculine.
I will tell you this:
one
of the reasons I've always loved Queen, other than the fact that it was the first record I got. The thing I liked about the way he sings is he's at 11. You know, he doesn't hold back. He's using his full voice. His range is deceiving. He just has power.
Oh yeah. Because he believes what he's singing. He's just really...
Yeah, yeah. He does, like, a lot of the highs you hear are actually the drummer.
Wow.
Yeah. Roger Taylor.
Well, you say that, but like you see some of the live stuff when it's just him up there, and there he still can hit the highs and lows. And
I'm not. Oh no, I mean, no, don't get me wrong. I'm not taking that away. Yes, he can. He definitely has a certain range, but sometimes his range is like in the studio and stuff is a little, you know, it's a little tricker. It's a little help with. From Roger Taylor.
Yeah, I mean, like both Roger and Brian both sang
but
their
he,
stuff.
But yeah, but all his stuff is always out. You know, even if he uses, well, I'm going to like say he's not going to go for the high note. He's going to use a different end like of a song, which happens because sometimes you get tired. He's always there. You know, like it's always the emotion. He's always on key. He was a master of that. It was natural.
And the transitions he could do from a low note to high in so quickly were amazing.
Yes. Listen to any Now I'm Here that's live.
Yeah.
When he plays with the audience. I love that shit.
Yeah.
But yeah, he was a consummate performer. I don't know how we got here. But I can always talk about Queen.
He can bring you to tears sometimes when he sings some of those
songs. There's one song.
You know, look at the Days of Our Lives. The last video they did when they knew he was dying, he knew he was dying, and he says, I love you to his fans. He looks right in the camera and says, I love you. That's the last thing he says on any video.
Geez,
that gets me every time.
It does. It chokes you up.
I tell you, there's one Queen song that is not a typical pick in anyone's freaking arsenal. It's I guess what it would be called is a deep cut. That I love, that I will feel that part of my life is complete if I get to perform it live with a band.
I know which one mine is, but which one are you talking about? I'm thinking of Love of My Life.
It's off of... That's
the one I was on.
That's a great song, too. Don't get me wrong.
Oh, my
God. But it's called Too Late, and the reason I love it is properly used, that is the greatest encore song you could close a show with. That song in itself is theatric in that it starts out a certain way, and then by the end, you are going balls to the wall. And it is sort of the showpiece. It has almost three acts to it, the way the song is structured.
I might have to hear that. I mean, I think I know which one you're talking
about.
It's
Late is what it's called. And it's on the We Will Rock You Out. Oh, you know, what do you call it? The one with the robot.
Is it News of the World?
Yes, it is, sir. Thank you.
Well, yeah, but what Jean was saying, actually, funny enough, I think she may have picked that one for the same reason I did, because Love of My Life is the one which... I like, which was released as a single, but it didn't really do much. But that one it's got the same line in it as Days of Our Lives, because he says in that one, you'll remember when we grow older and everything's all by the way and blah, blah, blah. And he goes, I still love you.
Oh,
and that's the same line which he uses in Days of Our Lives.
You're going to make me cry.
Well,
so beautiful.
If I could go back in time and redo our wedding song, it would be You're My Best Friend.
Well, I love that song.
Everyone's getting choked up in here now. There's
maybe,
like big,
yeah, we're
big
all crying.
Glassy eyes going on.
And I don't know, I'm getting all.
And we got to see him on the Colbert
I'm getting
show.
All like,
it's all crying. Tying. It's all crying together.
Okay, people, we are crying over here now. Just to let you know, you can't see us.
Well, there's
grateful,
some choke up tears going on in here.
A grateful kind of, you know, feeling right now.
Yes. Anyway, so let's get off all this emotionally saucy stuff here and move on to some...
Oh, you just can't handle it, Scott.
Yeah,
I know.
Oh, I'm fine.
Put on your mustache and be a man.
Hey, you know,
May I share mine with you?
You're cute.
South Park.
South Park. Hey, you know what? It's an emotion.
Is it?
It is. Whatever it is. I guess it's
Anyway, so that's our Queen thing, and now we have to get back to
Talk Salad.
Yes, we talked a little bit about it, and that was the thing we came in on. The noise you hear on the latest episode is the vacuum for the pool.
Did he?
Oh, yeah, we talked before the mics went on, didn't
we?
Yeah. Now, during the show, did Kevin ever address the sound? Or
he said there was work going on, but I think the work going on was the pool being cleaned, because in an earlier episode Andy had referred to the water that is over our heads, so you know that his office is beneath that 3 foot
underground
pool.
Lair for
yes, exactly.
He's in like the basement or something.
Yeah, but if you've seen his house, and there's pictures online, not that I'm stalking.
Right.
But there is a the pool is not like a traditional in-ground pool. It's in-house. It's on like a level of, you know, like a patio level. Technically, it's an in-house pool. First of all, it's only 3 feet deep, but it's not in the ground. It's recessed.
That's interesting.
But it's part of the house, essentially. It's part of the patio. And so knowing that it's over his head, it must be part of the structure.
Oh, okay. So it's not a separate entity. It's a part of the home. I love Randall. I love Randall.
Accounts, every time he says it's like, well, I don't think there's any point in doing another Clerks film. Which he said on the second one, then he saw the script and goes, you bastard, now I've got to do it. And I think that's what he said to the third script, by all accounts, as well.
And that's what you want.
At the the ending of Clerks 2, like, you have to do another one.
Give it up to that guy, man.
He was
Jeff
phenomenal.
Anderson makes me cry. And if I, and very frequently, that scene makes me cry.
It's a beautiful, like, statement.
Yeah, the whole thing. It's said with such conviction. As Kevin would say, he is telling the lie that tells the truth in that scene.
And the way Kevin speaks, the way Kevin writes and speaks, those are Kevin's.
Yeah, and the instinct to give the pivotal moment, like, oh, and he's there. Right. When you he's there. I love that movie. A lot of people shit on Clerks 2. I don't know how the fuck you could.
I think it's perfect.
It's a perfect sequel. It's a great movie. It's very funny.
And also, there's that scene where he is there, I talk in the jail, and there's that, as you say, very touching speech which is given by Randall. But there's this one moment where he delivers, which, if you know, after you don't even necessarily spot it the first time you watch it, but like the second time I was watching it, I noticed just one of the lines is so silly. And if you listen back, you know, it made me laugh because there's this line where he goes, oh, look. Back then when we were making friends, or, you know, when we were back in high school, if I'd known just 20 years later you'd be walking out on me like this.
You want to hear something? That line is from True Life. That is what he said to Scott Mosier when, but it was one point where, you know, Mosier wanted to walk the earth like Kane, you know, as he...
Like Kung Fu.
Yes, as he does. So, but Kevin has said that's where that came from. That's a line from Life to Scott Mosier.
Wow.
That scene. I said that to Joey once.
And you don't think about, like, and it's so human as well, because, like, think about the fact that, well, in the case of your podcast, like, what you've been doing it 2 years, 3 years, whatever it was, you know, oh, if I'd known you were just going to quit after 3 years of doing it, like, that's a lot of shows. That's a really good run.
Yeah.
I know.
Instinct is to get hurt and go, it's like, oh, you're just walking out on me already after only 3 years, you know, and that seems so real as
well. But that speaks to what a loyalist Kevin is, because he really feels connected to these people. His energy is an ingredient to this. Right.
And to him, they made him who he is.
Yeah. You can hear more of that if you ever listen to the Meggles episode, where we got our closing line.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
that's
where that came from.
Yeah.
That's what they would call a core value. I feel like we're walking all over Dr. Squee.
That's okay. I was just listening. No, you know.
Well, I'm here sitting thinking about how I want to start an Indiegogo to get to Indie Mac User's wedding.
you know what?
I want to go so bad. I've been thinking about it.
I think that would be kind of crass.
Also, that's a bit frivolous. Look, if you're making potato salad, we're kind of but that's just silly.
Yeah, that's right. The famous potato salad campaign.
I know. And you know what?
That was amazing.
I'm just speaking what I'm thinking. I'm not doing it, but it was just like, I was just going through my mind how I want
to
be there.
There are, you know, people who want you to pay for their vacation. Tell them Steve Dave talked about this recently. And they said that's where they drew the line. Save it up for the shit that matters.
So anyway, as we were saying, talk salad and scrambled eggs.
Yes. I love it. I've never watched Frasier. Did you watch Frasier prior?
Yeah, I watched it start to finish. I love that show. I've seen every episode a million times.
So okay,
for me, this was like just such comfort food listening to this podcast.
Yeah, I've never been a fan. I never sat back and watched the show. I never really thought to, because, you know, a show that's a full run, you always go, shit, that's a lot. So this gives me the opportunity to experience it, and I'm loving it.
And I started watching, like, back into the Cheers days. I watched from it was in reruns, but I've watched all the Cheers, and I watched that growing up. And that still to this day, I think, is one of the best sitcoms ever. And it's just such a simple format, but it's so genuine. Yeah. And so I just followed through into Frasier, sorry. So for me, it was just like, you know, thank God. I never would have thought to ask for a kind of Frasier podcast, especially not now, this long afterwards. But this is so Kevin Smith to give you something you never thought you wanted. And like the first two episodes, he released the pilot episode of Talk Salad, and then he released the first episode proper, very close to each other. And I just listened to 3 hours in pretty much back to back. And
I did the same thing.
To another three.
I appreciated the fact that they dropped what a lot of shows are doing now, a zero episode, you know, the pilot, the explaining of the premise of the show. And then the next show, boom. And it was right out of the gate. And they kept referring to next week, but it was like the next day or 6 hours later or whatever the fuck they dropped the next show. So, yeah, I consumed both of them back to back. And the second show dropped last night, I think, or the night before. So
yeah, and is it fantastic as well that was that a on an at midnight they were coming up with worst ideas for a podcast, and he jokingly said talk salad and scrambled eggs, Frasier reconsidered, and then sometimes later Kev was talking about doing Frasier podcast, and Matt Myra got wind of it, and they start doing it together, and he talks about this like it was just a stupid joke, but then the more I thought about it, I thought it's like no, that actually would be really cool to do. So yes.
Especially if Kevin was involved.
Such a meta joke, though, eh?
Yes.
Well, see, it's in one of the episodes, I think. I don't know if it's in one of the first two or the third one, which just dropped, but... it's just so much fun.
Yeah, yeah. And yeah. I have a feeling this will pull Matt Myra a little closer into the Smodcast family, as it seemed to do with Andy, and apparently with Mark Bernardin.
Yeah, and I feel like, because maybe the sensibilities are similar, and also because... Kev and Chris Hardwick are mates. I feel like there is this kind of it feels like they're very brotherly, those networks, the Smodcast and the Nerdist.
Well, I just love the new, the talk salad and scrambled eggs. Especially I love the closer today because they're like, see, you can do a podcast on anything, even a goofy podcast about commentary about a show that hasn't been on the air in 10, 20 years. So
yeah.
It was a good closing. I'm enjoying the opportunity to take the journey with them. I like doing this with What Say You and the Fast and Furious movies, too. This was, never would have watched those fucking movies, ever.
No. And my son had been going on about them for ages. And when and I was going, it's like, oh, I'll never be interested in those. But then I saw it was coming out in cinema. So I was kind of like thinking, it's like, well, maybe I could watch them with him so I could go to the cinema with him. And I was already mulling over the idea. And then they start doing that on What Say You. And I was like, no, son, I'm in, definitely. Let's start watching them. And because I had a mission to do it now to understand those podcasts.
Did you watch 3 Tokyo Drift accidentally like I did?
Well, not accidentally. I watched them purpose because they said they were going to watch it.
Yeah, exactly. I know. I feel gypped.
I'm waiting for them to, they've still got to come back around and watch that.
Oh, yeah. What do you think the chances of that are?
I had to say that, so.
Do you think they'll deliver? And as it turns out. It'll probably be closer when the next one comes out. They'll probably warm it up with Tokyo Drift.
Yeah, the thing is that those guys, it's very much in the kind of mold of Tell 'em Steve Dave, the fact that they kind of think of all these great ideas to do. And also, they were very good at doing this on the tenderloins. They'd set up stuff they do because they really genuinely intended to do it, and then they forget about it. So, maybe they'll remember when they go to do the next one.
And the reason...
The
reason all that happens is because they're so fucking busy.
Don't get me wrong. It's the same thing with Kev. He comes up with all these great ideas that he genuinely always intends to do, I believe. Yeah. But then he has so many of them that if he did one, then he's not going to do the other. We're trading art here, basically.
Yeah.
If we get this show from Kev, if we get Comic Book Men, then maybe we don't get Plus One coming back, for instance.
Agreed. Everything, you got to throw everything up against the wall, and whatever actually comes to fruition. I mean, that's... As a podcaster, you must be seeing that. You have these great ideas for the show. Some of them work out. I want all of them to work out. They don't, it's just sometimes you can't.
And a bug can become a feature. You think that it's going to be a problem that someone, when you get them on the mic, you thought you'd have hours with them, and you've got all these kind of things you want to ask them about. And then they say on the day, oh, I can only do 45 minutes. So then you're forced to kind of condense down everything you're going to ask them, and the kind of pace the show picks up. But then sometimes when I listen back to those shows, they're the best because you were forced to work within a constraint, but it made it such a pacey interview that it's great. So, you never know. Sometimes having those restrictions makes things better by the nature of events.
Did you enjoy all the Terminator talk at the beginning of Talk Salad?
I did. And the only thing which makes me slightly nervous is that they've shown all this cool stuff, and they even released a clip where by the time this comes out, it won't be a spoiler. But basically, it shows a clip where they go into a scene from the original film, and then you've got Arnie as he is now popping in. But it's a clip they haven't shown before. And I'm just worried they've shown all the good stuff. I just hope there's more to come from it.
The reason I'm not feeling compelled to go see that movie is it feels self-aware, It has that sort of, it's shot like a big movie. So it it feels like you're on a set. It doesn't feel like you're on location kind of feel.
Okay, I mean,
like
the,
of 80s,
I like
the 80s action kind of thing. Like a
the way they've done it of kind of going into the events of the first film. And for me, it's kind of a weird kind of bookend for me of my cinematic life. Because when I was a kid, when I probably shouldn't have been watching that film, my brothers, who were like old enough to rent those movies, they bring home Terminator, Terminator 2. And I think I was just 15 when the second one came out. And I watched them and just, I thought they were great. They were the like best thing ever when I watched them as a kid. So now having this one, when my son's old enough to go and see it, and I'm going to go along and take him along, it just feels like such a wonderful bookend to every movie I've ever seen in a very weird way.
But I and really, just, yeah. I'll say that I really like the third one. I was so happy to hear Matt Myra say that because I never shat on that one. I always thought it was good. I thought it was a great, for at that time, ending to the trilogy, it wrapped events so that they could happen again, which is a great way to end any kind of thing like that.
And the Terminatrix was a bit cheesy, but I did love it. Yeah, the
really?
End of it,
you thought she was cheesy? I thought she was hot. I was a young man, so I still think she's hot. Yeah. So why not have a hot Terminator?
But I just don't think she was the best actress for it.
Oh, yeah, that woman was pretty. I thought you were talking about Linda Hamilton.
Yeah.
She was great to look at, but it'd be nice if she could act too. You know, that's all I'm saying.
I think she did perfect for what she had to do, which was nothing. I mean, she just had to be, you know,
I don't know. The thing which I don't like about her is the reason why Arnie was perfect was, and maybe it was partly because he didn't speak the language so well, but he just looked like a robot. He didn't show emotion with the lines he was saying. And I think at the time, maybe he didn't understand everything he was reading. I think his English was a bit broken then, and it just conveyed that he was like just reading it flat.
Yeah.
And I felt like she showed a lot of emotion, which you could say is an upgrade of the software or whatever else. But I think the Terminator, the beauty is, it should be robotic. That's what I liked about a clip which I did see, the clip I was talking about before. They showed a CGI'd young Arnie, which looked amazing. Like, you know, and in this one, it showed he kind of, when he was talking,
fighting
the CGI
himself,
even worked better because it's like the only thing that moved on his face was his mouth. Like there was no emotion in the rest of his face. And that's what Arnie always did well. So I think she didn't capture that bit of it very well.
I liked Claire Danes in that. I liked the fact that there was a woman in it who wasn't necessarily tough, but had to essentially hold her own in that universe.
Well, the whole plot of Terminator is not just trying to take out John Connor. He's trying to take out all his lieutenants from the future. So Claire Danes was someone who he was meant to marry and was meant to help him have the power to lead the resistance.
Yeah, yeah.
And so she was a primary target as well. So that added something to it as well.
Yeah, it was another way in without necessarily redoing themselves and also so that they could reset the mythology. So you could actually go and start over again after watching the third.
And just when they go into the bunker in that moment where they just realize everything they've been working for to get into this bunker and they look at that machinery.
They caused it.
It's all rubbish 70s tech.
Yeah.
Oh, just that was just such a great moment. First time you watch that, it's so powerful when they realize just they've lost.
Yeah.
But they've kind of won in another way because they can lead a resistance.
Essentially, they reset the franchise by making it as a paradox. It was going to start over again.
Yeah.
But then I never saw the next one.
I've got it on DVD. I watched it. I did watch it when it came out, but someone was telling me, like, we were talking about the Terminator movies, and someone told me back some stuff which happened, and I go, did it? Like, I really could not remember anything from it, which isn't probably a good sign.
I haven't seen it. After the third one, I was like, well, they ended it so nicely. Why do we need this new one? There we go. We just drifted into another talk salad and scrambled eggs topic, even though it's not part of that show.
By the way, if you can hear some heavy breathing on the mic right now, this isn't just me getting overexcited. My canine co-host from my podcast, Dottie Who, has come to join us.
Yay! I was wondering if she was around. Again, I want to thank you for spending so much time with us and rambling like crazy people. And I enjoy it. And I can't wait till next time. And thank you for the compliments.
Yes, and thank you for coming on and taking your time out.
Well, right back at you guys. Thank you very much. Yeah, this is a lot of fun.
Love fest.
Yay.
All right. Until next time, please check out Gallifrey Stands out on iTunes and again, Stitcher. You're on Stitcher.
Right? iTunes, Stitcher, the Tangent Bound Network, Gallifrey Stands podcast.podbean.com, at Dr. Squee. I'm on Instagram.
You have a lip balm,
you can,
sir.
Write me a letter. You can send a carrier pigeon. I think that's all the social media.
That's what I was most impressed with. You have a lip balm, sir. That was impressive to me.
That's really crazy. There's someone, go to blueboxbalm.com. There's someone who makes lip balms based on Doctor Who characters, and she's got a lip balm inspired by every single character. It's just incredibly insane. It's talk about things you never knew to want. It's like, so I've got lip balm based on my program.
I love that.
Which is amazing to me. Yeah, you're just like, wow, I never anticipated that this would ever happen.
So. Yeah, it's banana and French vanilla flavor, and it's inspired by Dottie Who out there. So, you know.
That's good. That's good. Inspired by the pooch herself.
Exactly.
See, my life will be complete when I have a lip balm. I mean, we have no tie into Doctor Who, so there's no hope for this plan whatsoever.
No, we'll have do something else. We're not going to get on the lip balm bandwagon. No,
unfortunately. It would be too far one off.
I love that, though, because I love lip balm.
She's a lip balmer. She's a lip glosser.
Lip gloss, lip balm.
Oh, well, genuinely, they're set out of Philadelphia, so they're over there in the States.
Oh.
I'm not just saying this because, I could have just dropped out the press, but genuinely, they really taste good, and they're nuts. They're great.
So what is the company again?
Blueboxbalm.com.
Yes. Blueboxbalm.com.
Yes, yep. And you can get the flavor, the Gallifrey Stands flavor, whatever.
And they're not called lip balms, they're called Geek Sticks, which I love as well.
Geek Sticks. Yeah, that could be a good thing.
Rub your Geek Stick all over my lips. I'd go pervert right away.
I did too, so that doesn't say much about me.
I happily will.
That doesn't say much about me because I totally went there too. So. We're just big pervs over here. So. The Geek Stick.
Especially if it's banana and what flavored? Your Geek Stick
French
is
vanilla.
French vanilla.
Banana and French vanilla.
French vanilla is a very popular flavor, yes. I'm sure.
And it was inspired by the fact that, because, they asked me for the flavor thing, and it was because every evening for supper, we give Dottie dog food in the morning, but in the evening she has banana and yogurt. She absolutely loves it. And so it's actually literally a dog's dinner you're getting,
She has banana and yogurt every night?
Among all the things you said in that statement, one of the things I enjoyed was listening to the way you kind of tried to speed and hide the noise in the background. You're total pro now, sir. You were adapting. I don't know that everyone noticed but sure picked up on it.
It's banana and yogurt. Yeah, she has that every evening because she had a bad stomach when we got her. She was like dangerously underweight. We got her as a rescue. So that was one of the things we recommended, which was good for her stomach. So the yogurt's quite calming and bananas apparently really good for dogs and they
now,
like it.
I have a question though. Do you give her plain yogurt?
Yeah. Well, so Greek yogurt's the best for them.
And is it plain?
Yeah.
No flavor.
Oh, I might try that with Lily. That might be a good thing for her to try.
Down. Yeah.
And the other thing which I did, which I did the juice diet like Kev did, I did that for a couple of weeks, lost about a stone. And in that, one of the main ingredients used kale. And apparently dogs absolutely lap that up. So if you use some kale as well, they love that.
What did you say you lost? You lost what stone?
A stone.
A stone. So what is that in translation to old English units?
14 pounds, I think.
Good for you.
Or 12 pounds.
And awesome. Did you do the beet thing? Did you get beet dick? He talks
beet
about
beet dick. What's that?
Apparently, if you eat beets, if you juice beets, you get fucking. It has a Viagra effect. You get a fucking.
Oh, you get a hard cock. Wow.
Kevin's been saying that you get a boner you can cut glass with.
Ooh, Jen must be happy.
And apparently, there's a natural sort of thing in beets. Ironically, you get beet dick, so you can beat your dick. I guess.
Yeah, because men need a lot of help with that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm sure if you can't get beat dick, it would, tell me you don't think all day about, I wish I could beat my dick.
On that note.
On that classy, highbrow note. Take care, man. Go have fun walking your dog. We enjoyed having you. And
speak to you soon, Scott. Speak to you, Gene. Okay. It's been great.
Wonderful. Bye.
Bye. There you go. The political madness. Dr. Squee. From Gallifrey Stands, please go over and check out his podcast, Gallifrey Stands. It's Doctor Who related, even though we discussed next to zero Doctor Who during this show. If you're a Whovian, you'll really enjoy it. Now, I am also very fascinated at how many things between the conversation which took place several weeks ago with Dr. Squee and the conversation that took place with our next guest, because several things come up. I mean, we talk a lot about social media, Kickstarter, and Indiegogo. And while I say in this interview I referenced the chicken salad, I meant the potato salad. I couldn't believe that came up. There are many similar touch points
in this interview. Queen, we talk a lot about Queen. Now we can crack open another sci-fi realm. We went, you know, we had a touchstone of Doctor Who. Now we can go to another very British sci-fi touchstone, which is Flash Gordon. While Flash is American and the story is American, that was made very much in a European sensibility. So that's why it's like a very sort of sexy space. Does not look like space from Star Wars. It's like, planets are like masses of stuff. Hey, look, that's a planet. It's like four or five rock formations.
Lots of gold and stuff.
Yes, a lot of sequins.
Sequins and gold.
Big costumes, half-naked ladies walking around. Statuesque half-naked ladies all over the place.
Yeah.
So, made a very interesting time that as the 70s were petering out and the 80s were coming in. So here it is, my interview with Lisa Downs about life after Flash. At this time, I'm going to welcome to the show someone, this interview just sort of fell out of the Twitter, really. I'm joined by Lisa Downs, who's a filmmaker who's making a documentary on one of my favorite fanboy films, Flash Gordon. So welcome to the show.
Thank you. I'm sorry it's not a Kevin Smith film.
Oh, that's all right. That's all right. I mean, folks who listen to this show know that I'm a big fan of Flash Gordon.
So, oh, good.
Yes. So tell me how this happened and you know, I just saw you on Twitter, and as soon as I saw I was like, oh my God, I got to get involved. So
I know. And I was like, wow, someone messaged me about it. That's so exciting. it was just one of those things that I was in a place in my career, because I've been working in television for years now. And I was in a place where I just thought, I really want to do something that I'm passionate about. You know, you work on these things for broadcasters and commissioners and, you know, it's a job. And I just thought, I really want to do something for me. Mm-hmm. And I happened to be at a party with a friend about a year ago now. And it was a girl that worked on The Jump, Lisa Doyle, who's the other girl involved.
Oh, wow.
She worked on The Jump, which in the UK, which Sam was scheduled to be on, but broke his arm. So he couldn't actually do the show, but she hung out with him a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And she was like, oh yeah, I've just been doing this with Sam. And I was like, what? Flash Gordon, like the Flash Gordon was here and you were working with him? And she said, yeah, you know, he's lovely. And you know, he loves Flash Gordon. I said, do you know what? I would love to do a documentary about, and this was after a few drinks, and normally these things don't really escalate after that night. Yeah, I was like, I really want to do a documentary about him and his life and what it's like being known as his one character, and kind of like a Where Are They Now, but about the film and about him.
Yeah.
And then she's like, okay, put up a treatment. So I did a treatment. We sent it to his agent. The next thing I knew, we were on a call with him. And then we were suddenly out in Texas in January filming for the crowdfunding video. So it kind of just all happened really quickly and really organically, but it was just really exciting, and I didn't expect him to say yes. And I remember like Facebooking my friends as I was on that first phone call going, yeah, you'll never guess who I'm Skyping. it was so exciting. It was really surreal. But so that's kind of how it happened. I didn't know where it would go. And it's one of those films that you could go down the television route, or you could go down a theatrical route. And I really feel like this could be a really great feature documentary. And also you have the creative control over commissioners. So that's why we've also gone down the crowdfunding route. But that in a nutshell is kind of how it happened.
That is so cool. So how did you become a fan of that film? Why did this, while having a few drinks, did Flash Gordon pop? Most people wouldn't even know him as an actor, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, I think it's just there's a staple set of films that I've had in my life from when I was really little. And apart from The Goonies, I remember the trailer being on television. I didn't see it in the cinema, but I remember it being advertised on TV. There's like I don't really remember when I first saw them, but it's the kind of films that you get excited about every time they're on TV or someone talks about them. And Flash Gordon was always one of them for me. And I don't remember when I first saw it. I just remember like having it, it's like how you don't remember how you breathe, but you can, so it just was there, and I've just always loved it. I just think it was really just an amazing, magical world that I wanted to be a part of.
I'm so much there with you. When I was a kid, very vivid memories of the ritual, initiation scene.
Yes.
That was like, wow. Oh, it was I was 10 or 11 when I saw it. And that movie, it was like Star Wars, Clash of the Titans, Empire Strikes Back and Flash Gordon were like, those were our heroes. You know, those are the movies we loved.
It is. And I remember I used to take, I think I must have been about six or seven. I used to take my sister down to the garden and get her to stick her hand in holes to see what would bite her. And it only, I think, occurred to my mother what I was doing after a few months when she was like, I don't understand what she's doing with her sister down in the garden all this time. But I was like, I wonder what would bite her if I put it in, you know. So it's just, you don't know how these films influence you. But I just remember wanting to be part of their world, and I'd put like jewels around my head and, you know, it's just, yeah, it's funny. And that's part of what I want to cover in this is, you know, the film, it's life after Flash, and not just for Sam, but for other people in the film. But also fans, you know, like Seth MacFarlane became creative because of Flash Gordon, and Edgar Wright has been inspired by it. So it's not just life after Flash, but yeah, for Sam, it's how one film can inspire and influence everyone, you know, and still 35 years later, I think it's amazing. But there's a few things coming out now. Like there's, I think Sam's actually in Comic-Con this weekend to sign and launch the Entertainment Earth action figures. And, you know, there's a few things coming out now because of, I guess, the anniversary.
Yeah, it's very exciting. And so your movie comes at a good time.
It does. Do you know what? It really does. And it was kind of fortuitous. I remember Sam, the phone call. He said, you know, he gets so many calls about these kind of things. But he had just been talking to his wife and said, you know what? I feel like something's going to happen where I can really have a platform to do something. And then the next day he got our email. So he was, that's that, I think, because I was like, why would he say yes?
Podcasting.
I think that's why he said yes, is because it just, it was very fortuitous for everyone. You know, the timing for everything, the fact that it was 35 years. You know, I'm talking to Sam about doing the reunion at the end of the year as well, which we actually have some yeses for already, which is exciting. But we're still kind of fine tuning what that would entail. But, you know, I mean, it's very early stages for us at the moment. And our trouble is we're in the UK and he's in the US. So to do an actuality documentary on someone that's not in the same country, obviously, is quite challenging. So
we found some ways around that.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Oh, you were saying you had a second unit director out there.
I do. I have a second unit guy out there.
Yeah, so, but I'm really precious. I want to do this. I want to be there.
Believe me, I very much understand. And
yeah.
And the reason that I'm able to give that up is because about over the past year, I've really developed a relationship with this guy. Just seemed like kindred spirits. And, you know, over time, we just became close. And I could tell. I trust him is really what it comes down to.
Important because your thing's a really passion project, too.
Yeah,
and you need someone that you go, you know what, I know it's in good hands. And I think for me, one of the things, too, it's such a personal thing. Like some of the things I want to ask Sam are really personal, and it's, I want to get to know him, and I feel like it's not the kind of thing I can just send a camera operator over.
That's like me, you know, and Kevin.
I want to spend some time with him and, you know, really get to know him and get him comfortable with us and the crew and go from there. But yeah, so in the meantime, we've been doing UK interviews. So we interviewed Richard O'Brien and the special effects supervisor George Gibbs and Trevor Butterfield, who you should know from Star Wars.
Yes.
So we interviewed him too. He was lovely. And Ornella Muti has said yes to an interview, so we need to get to Rome as well for that.
So do you know how much Dune influenced Flash Gordon? Jaborski's Dune? Have you seen that documentary?
I haven't.
Oh, you should. If you get a chance.
See, okay.
Jim, I can't remember that. He's a famous artist and expressionist and director. Jaborski, I can't say his name properly. But it's his name, Dune. And it tells the story of he was the original director of Dune. And he put together a creative team for Dino De Laurentiis that essentially went on to, like, so much of that team fed Flash Gordon and fed the Dune that they actually made.
Right.
And many
See, I've got it on IMDb now.
Yeah.
2013. Okay.
There's costume designs that are in Flash Gordon that were made for Dune.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And that's why it has that fantastic look and, you know, that, I mean, it is so surreal, and it's like this weird bit of 70s kink in there and just sort of like, it's not sci-fi typical, you know?
Exactly. exactly. And I think that's what makes it stand out, and I guess why it still held its own 35 years later.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's really, especially, you know, we were talking to Melody when we met in Laredo in January when we were filming, and, you know, she was like, people kind of make fun of it a little bit. You know, yeah. They see it as camp, but she said the work, like these women, these Italian seamstresses and everything yeah. that was going into the costumes and the set, it was just...
Yeah,
I mean, she was saying she's really surprised it didn't. It's kind of maybe as comical as it sounds that it didn't win an Oscar.
And the secret just said is it was a lot of that came out of this Dune project.
Okay, I'm going to watch that.
Yeah, you got to check it out. Yeah, you were just saying though how people think it was camp and all. I'll never forget one of the best things about having kids. I don't know if you have kids.
I don't.
I have two kids, and I tell my friends the best reason to have kids is to show them cool movies, because it's as close as you're ever going to get to seeing it for the first time. Because I got so excited when I showed Flash Gordon. He had heard in advance, you know, oh, it's kind of silly and campy.
Mm.
And then I put it on. He was converted. He loved it.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's what I think. When we were out filming, we spoke to a lot of the fans at the Comic-Con that we were at. And the thing that they were most excited about was that now they have kids. They remember the first time they went to see the film with their fathers in the cinema, and now they get to be the dad and give them their kids the same memory, you know, and have that experience. And they just said it's really special to have that, you know, come full circle again.
You should try and get Seth MacFarlane from Family Guy.
Yes, we are in talks. Ooh, so there's a few. This is why I need to be in LA.
That's great.
There's a few big interviews that I won't say. Yes. But pretty much, there's a lot of people that we want to interview for this.
I can identify with so many things you're saying, because we are in very much the same boat.
Yeah. How's yours going?
I mean, other than the Indiegogo thing, which, you know, you cross your fingers and you hope it goes well, it's more of a way to get the word out. We're doing this thing because enough of the right people are involved.
Yeah.
You know, it'll just take a little longer.
Yeah. Right? I mean, that's the thing I'm finding difficult. Like, on social media, we have quite a good following, and, you know, the numbers are there.
Huge, but also, following. Since I looked, I was like, wow.
They're dedicated. That's what I love. Like, I have people emailing me going, I've just written a press release for you. Is it okay? Can you approve it? I'll send it out to 800 people tomorrow. Like, yeah, that's fine. Yeah. You know, and I have people writing articles, and it's really amazing what everyone's doing. And I come across articles, I was like, I didn't even know that was there, but people are really promoting it. But the hard thing is, it's so hard to ask people for money, and you don't want to really directly ask. So I've tried to make the rewards kind of, you know, cool, that you can't just get if you go to a Comic-Con, like personal training with Sam is one of them. You can have an hour if you're in the San Diego area.
And people don't get that. I don't think people get that. I mean, I don't feel good about, you know, I don't feel good about essentially e-begging. But
it's really hard. But the reality is, it can't be made if we don't get funding.
Yeah, yeah.
And sometimes it's not, you can't, what you want to do isn't conventional enough to go down a conventional route.
Yeah.
So, you know, we really want to make the film. We invested our own money to go out to Texas to do the initial shoot.
Oh, wow.
And now it's just, you know, the budget for this is, you know, 10 times as much as what we're asking minimum. But the reality is that we just need to get it made. We need footage. We need content. So we're just doing it very, very low key. Like, it's literally just two of us.
Yeah. Well, that's two or three people.
Yeah. But it is really tricky to just go, you know what? I really appreciate the shares and the likes and the articles, but it can't get the film made. Yeah. But, you know, I don't want to do this in a pushy way. So I don't know if that's a silly thing to do. People I've spoken to have said, you know what? You just have to ask. But I feel like it's, just doesn't feel.
I feel all the same ways. I identify with, like, I'm like, it's my wife and I are the, you know, the primary drivers. She's more the producer, more the, you know, I'm more the creative type. So I'm not good with that as it is. And now I have to be a whore. And it feels weird.
Indiegogo whore.
Yeah, yeah. And now you're that guy.
do you know what? I think that sometimes, and like, I see things, you know, on Facebook, you get so many of people wanting, you know, pledges and charities. And you know, like, you know, I do try and support as much as I can. But then I think, what if, like the people that I don't support. I'm like, but I know how they feel. Like they actually support everything.
Well, like I know that
I can't live.
I know that you supported me, and I thought, I was like, oh, that's great.
I did.
And
Indiegogo buddies.
Yeah, and people go, well, why would you do that? And it's because it's just like, I know it's even Steven or whatever, but it's a way of, you know, showing solidarity.
Exactly. Yeah. And, you know, and people on Indiegogo, they offer perks. I got good karma from yours.
Thank you very much.
And it's, you know, getting something that maybe you can't buy.
Yes. And you'll also get a free bonus. You'll get a bonus pod that won't be on our feed as well.
There you go. Exactly. Yeah. That's exciting.
Yeah, you get all
yeah the, so I'm trying to do little specials and things every now and then. Like at the moment, we're doing these, we'll film Sam doing like a 7-minute workout. You know, you can get like as an app. So we'll film him and we'll personalize it. So anyone that contributes over £20 before we get to 50% gets your own personal training 7-minute by Sam.
Wow.
So see, it's like little things like that I think are special. And I liked yours as well that you offered. But
we kind of struggled with like, okay, we don't want to have to produce something to give something. You know what I mean? Like if we got to go make T-shirts now. To give, you know, that makes no sense.
It's tricky, isn't it?
That money would go much better into the movie, so let's avoid the...
I tried to really limit things for postage, but I found... Because we actually did a Kickstarter campaign at the beginning of the year.
Oh, yeah.
I cancelled it after like a week and a half because...
We talked about that.
Yeah, I hadn't done it. I hadn't researched. I was really we've got to quickly get this moving, and we put the budget way too high, and I hadn't... Yeah. Like even now, people are only just finding about the campaign. I've been promoting this since February that it's going to come out now. So, you know, a week really wasn't long enough. But what I found, a lot of the popular things, the posters were the most. So I thought, okay, we'll have a couple of printed things. But a lot of them are like voicemails from him and, you know, selfies with him.
Yeah.
So that kind of stuff. We're trying to make it fun. I know. It is really tough, though. And I think, you know, I sometimes wonder, is crowdfunding becoming too oversaturated at the moment and everyone's using it and you just people get inundated and it's you've seen one, you've seen them all. So I guess it is really you have to have something that attracts people with what it is, you know, whether it's supporting independent podcasters and filmmakers and you know, or you want some guy. I mean, I was straight on that Exploding Kittens thing that was out on Kickstarter that raised like 15 million you know, and I just, it's a hard one, I think, to, like, maybe people are getting fed up with it.
Well,
but.
I think the tipping point was the chicken sandwich or whatever it was, a chicken salad recipe.
What was that?
Oh, I can't, you didn't hear about this? I think
it
was either Kickstarter or Indiegogo, but it was like, it was essentially a guy said, you know, I want to make chicken salad.
Wow. Here's
my recipe, you know, and he wasn't asking for much. And he ended up making like thousands of dollars.
Isn't it crazy?
Yeah. And I think that was the tipping point. I feel like I wish I had gotten into this or had a reason to do it prior. I mean, things happen when they happen. But think about this. In 5 years, where will people be with this? You know?
Well, that's it.
They'll be saying, you got it in a good time.
For what it is now, you know, I guess it's as long as it helps people do even part of what they want to do. You know, a lot of them are products that you can buy, but say with ours, yours is flexible as well, isn't it? So you get the money without getting to the goal. So, you know, as long as that little bit helps you.
Again, I can go back to we have a lot in common because when we started doing the crowdsourcing, our DP, David Madison, you know, is very well connected and knows everybody. And he knew a gentleman who works for Kickstarter. So I went to talk to him and he sent me this packet of data. And when I started crunching the numbers and seeing like, I mean, it was very informative, but it had the opposite effect. Cause I'm like, I'm not going with Kickstarter. You know,
that's interesting. You say that. Cause I changed because Indiegogo actually called me. They emailed. I was like, I know that they just want everyone's business. But then I spoke to them on the phone and you know, Kickstarter for me, I know.
That all or nothing. No, that's fine. Yeah, that all or nothing.
Yeah, the all or nothing. Because then I was like, well, how?
It's way too stressful.
It is. But my worry was like, what if, actually my initial worry was with Indiegogo, with the flexible funding. What if I give perks that I can't fulfill?
Yeah.
Then it occurred to me that then I just don't give them. But Kickstarter, I just found that they weren't very... they weren't very hands-on.
Yeah.
I felt like it was just a company.
Yeah.
You know, and then thinking about the flexible funding more, then you realize that you can actually benefit from using those little bits. And Indiegogo have just started this new thing that if you raise your amount, your campaign can stay open indefinitely as
well. Yeah, I saw that. And it's funny because both of us got in at the wrong time, but their fees are going to change too. The fee model is changing. It's going down to 5% flat.
Yeah, well, if we raise our goal, then we get 4%. So,
oh, is that what we have to do?
Every cloud.
Or yes, if you raise your goal. I don't know. I'm just about to crack 1,000, and that's like 1/15. So
It's tricky. You just don't know how. Is this your first campaign that you've done?
Exactly. This is our first campaign. Yeah. There's a film being made, over in Scotland called Shooting Clerks. I don't know if you're familiar with it.
I have heard of it.
Yeah, and those guys, 3 Indiegogo campaigns before they finally funded. Just as long as you keep going. That's what I think.
No, a lot of people now do like pre-production funding, then production funding, and come back and go, hey, we need to finish it. But I just don't feel like if you ask people for money once, I don't feel like you can go, hey, can I have some more?
But with the Shooting Clerks project, what's happening with our project, you know, behind the scenes, as people agree to be part of it, like it builds up momentum and steam.
Yes.
So like something's going on. So pre-production, yeah. But once you start to put these elements together and like, hey, I have footage of these people, then people become more enthusiastic because you've done the work.
Yeah, that's true. That's very true.
Yeah, so you never know.
That's true. You never know. But yeah, I mean, fingers crossed. It's as long as we keep doing what we want to do and we're passionate about, there's always going to be someone else who'll support it.
So you've sat down with Sam and interviewed him with Flash.
I have. It was really... Do you know, it was really cool to just hang out with him. Like, we just went to Mexican food one night, and we were at nearby hotels, and so we hung out with him a little bit during the day too, and we just followed him everywhere. And then
and he's in Texas?
I have to say, this was at the Laredo, the South Texas Comic Con and Expo. It's like 3,500 people, I think. Like, it was quite small.
What city?
This is my first Comic Con too, so it was like baby steps.
What city?
Laredo, Texas.
Oh, Laredo. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, it was a really great little Comic-Con. But Sam and Melody were there. So we hung out with Sam for a little bit, you know, went to dinner the first couple of nights. And then the third night, and I have to say, this was probably one of those moments where you think, I just don't actually know what I'm doing. Because I was at dinner with Ash Hour, the producer, and Melody and Sam. And I just thought, I'm sitting here with Dale and Flash. And I don't actually know what to say. I was really nervous, but what was really cool and what I loved that I hope I can do this kind of thing in the film is that, you know, you hear people do interviews and you hear the same stories quite a few times and, you know, they've kind of got the media wall up. But when they were just chatting, I was like, they're telling stories I've never heard before about their time on set and how it was with the film and what they've done since. And I just thought that's what I want to put across in this, in the film. But it was just very cool. He just loves it. Like, he loves being Flash. He loves the fans. He really appreciates them. Like, when we first walked into, I turned away from him for 30, like a third of a second. And he was already over somewhere being offered helicopter rides and signing things and taking photos. And it was just crazy, you know? But what was interesting is that he, to the younger generation, was like, that's the guy from Ted. That to me, that's the guy from Ted. And, you know, so they, and some of the younger kids didn't even know him as Flash Gordon.
That's so funny.
Was weird. Yeah,
that's
he's going to have a Ted banner at his next Comic-Con. But yeah, we were very, very lucky that he let us kind of hang out with him. You know, we did the circuit, like we met him at like 5 a.m. one morning and did his media press circuit with TV and radio. And, you know, he's totally up for anything. Which is what we've been really, really lucky with this, because we'll go and hang out with him in San Diego too once we get out there.
You know the story of how he was cast, right?
He was on the dating show,
and I believe it was Dino De Laurentiis' wife.
It was.
Yeah.
Yeah, he said that's your Flash Gordon.
He's cute.
yeah, exactly. But he said he got flown to London for about a month of auditions and castings, and he just said no one ever said anything. He didn't know if he was coming or going. He just kind of sat in London, waited for a month. And then someone made a really, like, kind of a side comment about, oh, yeah, so when you're starting to film Monday. And he was like, okay, that was a bit anticlimactic to let me know I've had the job. You know, I've been sitting here for a month waiting, not knowing what's happening. Yeah, whereas Melody literally had to fly the next day. She was out, had to fly from LA.
Max von Sydow was genius in that.
He was amazing.
Amazing.
Yeah, he was. Sam actually told, I don't think we've released this interview yet, but when we were interviewing him, he said Max gave him the best lesson he's ever had on set, because you know how when they film, the camera's on one person, they do their lines, and then they turn the camera and get the lines from the other actor, but more often than not, you're talking to a tennis ball or a bear or someone who's not in costume anymore because they're not on camera. He said when he did his lines and he was on camera, Max came out in like his 60-pound costume. It was boiling hot. He did his lines exactly how he did. And Sam was like, you don't have to do this. You know, you're not being filmed. And he was like, I take this very seriously. We're going to be in character and I expect you to do the same for me. You know, we're in this. This is how it's going to be done. And he just, you know, he said he was amazing. He wasn't a diva at all.
Total pro.
So, total pro. That's what they say. So then Sam returned the favor, and he said he's always done it since. You know, it's respect to the other person. So, yeah, he was kind of cool.
Topol's in that too.
Yes, and I don't know. I mean,
he's in my favorite James Bond movie of all time.
Which one is that?
For Your Eyes Only. I know it's a Roger Moore one. But
I think I just saw them so separately that I didn't piece that together.
Yeah, yeah.
Great
so he was sort of this 80s figure in my mind.
Mm-hmm. See, he's someone that I would love to interview, but is he in Israel again?
I don't know.
I don't know what happened to him.
That's your job as the filmmaker.
Yeah, then people who have the same question can watch the film and find out.
Yeah.
If we crack the code first. Yeah. But, you know, what I love about it too is that people who you don't expect to be in it are in the film.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
Kenny Baker was in the film and Robbie Coltrane was in the film. But yeah, there's do you know Downton Abbey over where you are?
Yes, we have it on the Netflix. And
so for all those Downton Abbey fans, like Jim Carter, who's the main guy in it. I've never actually watched it, but he's the main guy.
Neither have I.
He was an Azurian man in Flash Gordon, and that was his first film, and it was Robbie Coltrane's first feature film. And you know, there's all these people that Blue Peter Duncan, our Blue Peter presenter that everyone knows and loves here, was in it, and it's just everyone was in it. It's amazing. George Harris. So, yeah, we're going to try and get hold of everyone.
So
it would be amazing.
You know the little story that Seth MacFarlane talks about seeing that movie, right?
The story I know is Sam's version about when he phoned up to be in Ted. What's your story?
Oh, no. I pull this right off. If you watch some of the commentary episodes, they do a spoof. You know, they've incorporated Flash Gordon stuff into their show, you know, little cutaways.
I've seen many episodes of Family Guy where they reference Flash Gordon.
Okay.
I love it.
One of the bigger ones is that, you know, where you Hawkman scene, you know.
Do you know what? I saw that last week. It was on television.
Yeah. So
it was amazing.
What he talks about is he had not seen Flash Gordon until somewhat recently from when he was recording that or when they made that show.
This is Flash Gordon. That's Brian Blessed doing that voice that he did in the movie like 30 years ago, and
really?
He does not sound any different.
Now, we inserted this in the rewrite, I think. Hadn't you just seen Flash Gordon the night before or something like that?
Yeah,
and you're very excited about it?
Yeah, I was like, I'd just seen this brand new movie from 1980.
And you're like, we got to use this.
That's amazing. That's amazing.
Yes, so.
And that was what, when he was an adult?
Yes, as an adult, yes.
Ah, because Sam's version is that when he got called for Ted, he was like, Sam, I saw the film when I was 8 years old and I was hooked.
Really?
Yeah.
Ooh.
So maybe if we interview him, I can ask him and we can find out the truth.
Yes. Well,
I love it.
You can.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, do.
Well, would, what about this? What's this story here?
Yeah.
Anything for Flash Gordon?
Yes. Well, he did save us. He did save us.
Oh,
no,
yeah.
Oh,
God. We haven't even talked about music yet. And there's another thing. There's so many touch points to Flash Gordon in my life. I think I'm pretty much sure I became sexually aware as a result of Flash Gordon.
That's interesting.
Princess Aurora.
Yeah.
She was stirring things in me I did not know prior.
You're not the first male that said that, surprisingly. And probably not. There's probably a lot of females that said the same thing as well.
Agreed.
She's definitely a looker, and she actually still is. So I'm intrigued to go and interview her in Rome.
Ah, well, that's rich.
Yeah, so I'll have to send you a picture.
Oh, that'd be great.
But she's certainly the popularity, I think, of... Actually, one thing Richard O'Brien said was funny was that he said he thinks she liked him quite a lot because he just didn't... Everyone on set was kind of pandering to her because she was so beautiful. And he just kept asking her to go up to the pub for a pub lunch and didn't really do that, and I think she liked it.
What's funny is, you know, I've watched that movie many, many times. You know, it's probably a movie that my wife sort of dismisses because I've watched it so much. You know, it's more annoying to her. But then, I swear, it's so topical. It's so the timing is incredible. A couple nights ago, literally, I threw it on because it's one of those movies I don't mind falling asleep to.
Yeah, well, you know it so well.
Yeah, and Jean, my wife, was like, oh, my God. She was like, he's a hunk. Like, she suddenly discovered Flash Gordon. She suddenly discovered Sam. Like,
she just had her awakening.
Yeah, she did. She was like, wow, he's hot. And I was like, wow, really? You never noticed any of this before?
Wow, that's interesting. You better maybe watch out.
Yeah, I'm not worried.
Yeah, no, I think Sam's very happy with his wife and five kids as well. Yeah.
Does he have five kids? Yes.
He has five kids.
Wow.
Yeah. They actually, three of them were on the TED 2 red carpet.
Oh, wow.
On my Facebook page, the Life After Flash Facebook page, there's a couple up there. Yeah, his kids, I haven't met them yet, but they look amazing. Do you know what? It is funny. I just saw TED 2.
Okay.
And I think there are less funnier moments than in TED, but the moments that are funny are much more funny than in the first one. It is what you expect from a Seth MacFarlane film about a teddy bear.
I from what I've seen, I don't believe that Mark Wahlberg is acting.
Do you know, I think one of the greatest things to ever hit cinema is Mark Wahlberg going into comedy.
Really?
I think he is brilliant.
But I don't think he was acting.
Well, he does an accent in this one, so if that can be acting, he's very funny. I would go and see it. I would see it tonight if you can.
Is that a Transformer?
Yeah, I can't do a Boston accent.
that's my Walmart.
I can't do it. Maybe New Jersey.
Yeah. His brother's a brilliant actor.
Do you know what he is? Isn't he?
Yeah, he was in that. Do you remember?
You forget he was in Sixth Sense. Was that him in Sixth Sense?
He's
was
the killer. Yeah. He steals the scene.
Don't ruin it for people who haven't seen it. The ending.
Oh, come on. I think there's a moratorium on that one.
That's really in the Titanic sinks.
Yes. God, I remember that. I don't want to give away the ending.
No, I think that was a joke everyone made when they came out of the cinema.
Yeah.
It's a very funny film, and Sam's amazing in it. It's very not what you expect him to play. But yeah,
so another
he pulls out the Flash singlet tank top again.
I was about to say the icing on the cake as a kid, even as a kid going to see Flash, was that the biggest band of the time, who had just put out The Game not long before that, and had hits up the yin yang. Queen did the soundtrack.
They did,
which people kind of made fun of.
Why did they make fun of it?
I don't know, but I remember people being like, oh, yeah, Flash, you know. But meanwhile, it's huge. It's a great song.
It really just makes it. I mean, it completely. And you know that as soon as, it's like a Neil Diamond song where everyone knows the words. As soon as you hear the do, you know what's coming.
Tenacious D opens with it frequently.
Yes. it's brilliant, you know. And we are hoping to talk to one or two of Queen's members.
Oh,
It's such a big part of the film.
Oh my God. First of all, can I just say, if you get a chance, I know he doesn't know me, but Brian May has the greatest guitar sound ever.
I thought you were going to say The Greatest Hair.
No, no. The greatest guitar sound in rock and roll, without a doubt. Ugh. The first 45 I ever opened for my parents when I was about 6 was Bohemian Rhapsody. And the thing blew my mind. And ever since then, I've been a Queen fan. So
I don't know if you don't have HSC over. I went to school in Australia for a little bit, and so they have the HSC. Their final exams, I guess, in high school. And I attempted to play Bohemian Rhapsody on the piano. And I stuffed up the middle section, but it's really hard. But I was very inspired by Queen to play a Queen song, and I couldn't play Flash, so that was my second option because of Wayne's World.
In our 20s, in my 20s, I had a band and we did a lot of Queen, because if I was in a band, I was doing Queen. So
they're just good. Yeah. Have you seen that the Kanye Queen clip that's out from him at Glastonbury?
Oh, God, it's atrocious.
Where they compare it.
Oh, my God. Thank God the audience was there to sing.
It was really funny.
Yeah.
I have to ask you a question based on your email that you sent to me before we did this. Mm-hmm. Why you thought a female wouldn't be leading a Flash film?
Just talking to you, I don't even give it a second thought. But, you know, it's such a piece of my boyhood.
Mm.
You know, it's such a, like, slug your brother on the arm kind of movie. And
yeah,
you know, like, it just, it was, oh my God, it's a girl.
You're not the first person that's had that reaction.
I mean, yeah, and I didn't want to sound sexist or anything like that, but you know, it's just like, I can't.
Not taken.
And I was doing all the classic sexist stupid things like, I guess this is his wife's account that he's
That's what you said.
Yeah, well, to myself, you know, I guess it's his wife's account. Like, I didn't put two and two together until
she needs to keep tabs on him, of course.
Yeah, well, my wife is, like, in a producerial role, so she,
I found it really interesting that you said that, because to me, it's like second nature, loving it. So, I found it very interesting. You're like, wow, you're a female.
And a fan of Flash. That is totally cool. That is totally cool.
Yeah. So, yeah, I found that interesting.
And you're probably a Gen Xer, too. So, I was born 1970.
82.
So, no, you're millennial, aren't you?
I'm one of those weird ones that you don't know where to place me.
Yeah.
Yeah, but no, it's been interesting. I have to say, I felt like I was a minority at the Comic-Con. There's a lot of males there.
Yes, well.
But amazing cosplay outfits from the girls.
Yeah,
I mean, that, like I said, was my first Comic-Con, so I didn't know what to expect, and I think it was very mild. I've been seeing pictures from San Diego.
Yeah.
But you just think, wow, they go to so much effort. It's incredible.
By the time I get to San Diego, by the time I finally get out there, I feel like it's going to be so over.
When do you get there?
Oh, I don't. I mean, like, we're, you know, every year we go next year.
Oh, right. Okay, I thought you meant, like, literally next week. I was like, go see Sam.
However, we do have to, we have some of the same dilemmas. We have to shoot some folks out on the West Coast, and we're wrestling with when to do that. And, you know, originally we wanted to do the end of August. That was certainly hell. Yeah,
now, your internal flights in America, they're quite pricey, aren't they?
Yeah, they ain't cheap.
Well, so because I was thinking that's fine, we'll just go over and we'll just like fly around the country.
But
I looked at some flights.
It.
I was like, how do people? No wonder you have RVs. Like, that's crazy, the prices.
Well, think about it though, because in Europe, you're used to, you can be in another country in a day.
Do you know what that's? We can be in another country in like 50 minutes. It takes me to fly to Amsterdam.
Well, where are you?
London.
Oh, so you're London. So you're south. Yeah, you can go to France and take.
People go to France for lunch. Here.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, see, we can't.
I mean, if
do
you
that.
Want to spend that kind of money, or you can drive over, but
yeah, us, like, we're pretty much the closest country is Canada, that's to the north, and then Mexico to the south. So
I guess I forget how big it is. It's like me flying to Russia.
Yeah, yeah, pretty much. So that's
which you can actually for £35, you can get a ticket with Wizz Air. So you should come and do your documentary in England. It'd be much cheaper.
Oh, we would love to. You know, see, that's the thing you're talking about. Thanks to social media. Thanks to all, you know, the podcast, thanks to all this stuff, like, there are people in the UK I would love to meet, and I can't wait to. You know, there are reasons to go out there.
Yes.
You know, another couple years, I think, then, you know, hopefully.
I'll take you to the local haunts.
Yeah. And we have.
I
was going to say, like, Ben and Lewis are there. They're in, where the heck are they? They're in Wales, though.
Oh, right. Well, that's close. It's like a couple of hours.
See, there you go.
There's I don't know if you're a David Hasselhoff fan, but there's a pub near St. Paul's on Knight Rider Street, which is his favorite pub, and there's just filled like with David Hasselhoff signed pictures.
Ooh, I just realized how we can bring this back to Kevin from an email from a detail you gave me in the email.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I was so
cinema.
That's how you could tell how excited I am. One, I knew what you were talking about. And two, I was like, oh, that's so great. I actually said that. I fanboyed. Yeah. You've been to the bathroom.
I've been to the bathroom. I used it too.
Ooh.
Yeah. Get that.
What was that experience like?
So Prince Charles Cinema, I don't know if you're familiar with the actual cinema here, but it's like the best cinema for independent film. Like the if you're a member, tickets are like £4, or which is, what I don't know, like $7 or $8 for you. Mm-hmm. And they have like masquerade balls for Labyrinth. I went to a beer and pizza speed screening. I went to the Goonies anniversary screening. Oh, wow. They do like Charlie Chaplin films and,
so
you know, incredible range. They're really independent.
They make it an experience.
They make it, it's just cool. Yeah. And they're the kind of place that you go, I've never seen that on the big screen. You're like True Romance and you're like, okay, I'll go see this. And the girls, the girls' toilets used to be the men's toilets. And for whatever reason, Kevin Smith decided to sign the toilet that he used when he was doing a Q&A. And so it's still there on the toilet door.
I thought they put up a plaque, didn't they?
They might have covered it. I can't remember, it's definitely still there.
Yeah, from what I heard, yeah. So he signed it the first time, and he mentioned it during the Q&A, and I believe the theater owners like put up some sort of plaque or named it the, you know, Kevin Smith Memorial Stall.
I'll have to go back and check. I just remember his signature being there. So there you go. He did a Q&A, and whatever happened in there, whatever happens at Prince Charles stays in the Prince Charles.
There you go.
So when you come over, you'll have to use his toilet. I'll keep a watch because it's female.
That'd be awesome. God, this is so cool.
Yeah. I'm really pleased that we've got to get back to Kevin Smith.
Yeah. It's obligatory. So we've gotten that.
It is.
We've gotten that out of the way. Actually, what I'm finding is the longer I do the show, filmmaking is in Kevin Smith's milieu. You're a filmmaker. Boom. You're in.
Yeah. Woohoo.
You fit.
Yeah. Yeah. He's got an I in his name. I've got an I in mine.
I try not to stretch it that much.
Yeah. No, I actually did watch Clerks the other day.
And
so, Kevin, that counts, doesn't it?
Kevin is an enthusiast and a booster of the arts and of independent filmmaking.
Yeah. And I was actually, I really enjoyed his podcasts.
Oh, they're great.
Yeah, linked. I don't know how many sets he's done. I listened to the one where he was talking about Jason and the drug problems, and you know, that was. I just found it fascinating.
There are hundreds of hours now.
Right.
Hundreds.
I listened to these. Must have been like 2006, 2007, maybe.
Okay. Yeah.
So
there's
whatever was out.
Yeah, he's got...
actually. It was listening to those that some friends of mine when I was living in Sydney decided to do our own podcasts. 8 weeks we gave ourselves doing. Every weekend to see how many followers we could get. And we did cooking shows and we all put effort in. And the one that got the most was dancing girls in underwear. I was writing choose your own adventure scripts and we had, you know, it was amazing. And dancing girls.
I haven't heard choose your own adventure stuff at all. That's like your books.
It was fun. So we'd do a script and then we'd film it and launch it. And then we'd go, what do you want to happen? And then people would vote. And then within that week, we'd write the new script and film it for the next week.
That is cool.
Yeah. See, but Dancing Girls got the most, so all that work that we put in. But it was fun to do. It was really fun to do. So I enjoy the podcast medium. I think it's still a great way to be entertained.
What it is, what I found it to be is a great incubator of other projects as well.
Mm, yeah.
So like out of this show grows a movie. You know, like it was never my intention, but there we go. So
I think everything happens for a reason. Yeah. And you stumbled across my tweet.
Yes.
And it was fortuitous. Oh, dude. So I really appreciate it.
Well, in that respect, yes. And then we can promote your project. And there's other, I mean.
I guess it's a bittersweet time that we're in an age where everyone can be a filmmaker. You don't have to get your Super 8 camera and film and get edit suites in the city and. So
well, you don't have to work in film. Then, as soon as you remove film, it becomes a much different, you know, because that was it. That's where all the expense was.
now you can film something on your iPhone and edit on your computer. So you've got that competition with other people that everyone is doing. You're so inundated with short films, and but then you're so exposed to so much. So it is kind of a bittersweet time. But having said that, if it was back how it used to be, I couldn't be doing this.
You hit on the right subject. The fact that you're a woman doing it too is just now. I mean, now that I reflect, it's another cool thing. You know, it's like, wow, that's unexpected.
Go women.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. I'm very much an advocate in doing what you're passionate about. I spent a lot of years working till 3 a.m. on adventure travel programs that just didn't interest me, and you know, it just wasn't my bag. And so to do things that, you know, if anyone has a project that they just go, you know what, I've been wanting to do that for a while. I just think, find a way to do it.
You Brits love those travel shows.
We do. Oh, we have some really rubbish shows as well.
I got sucked into the Michael Palin ones. But I like Michael Palin.
You know, they're not bad. We love a good travel show, but we also love the celebrity shows here. I think you do too. Like, we've now got celebrities roller skating. We had celebrities diving.
Yeah, you guys are big on reality, or what we call reality.
Oh, we love it. We've currently got a show where you watch people watch television.
Oh.
Gogglebox. You literally just watch people watch television.
Do you know
and see what they comment on it.
Do you know Impractical Sorry? Jokers? Impractical Jokers, the show?
No.
Okay.
Is that like punked?
It's kind of like, from what I understand, it started here. It started from four guys in Staten Island here. And they kind of have a tangential connection to Kevin Smith. So, like, that element is incorporated into this show very much.
Love it.
But from what I've understood, in England, they were making a British version. So they sort of licensed it.
Yeah.
But what had happened was, the fans of the show found out about the U.S. version, and now they don't want the British version, so they're just putting out the U.S. version there.
It doesn't surprise me. It really doesn't surprise me.
Well, if you get a
chance. We also love a good American show here. I mean, we really do. But it surprises me that we have Sky here, and we have like 700 channels.
Uh-huh.
And every day I flick through, I'm like, there's literally nothing on. There's 700 channels. And there's nothing on. I mean, it's terrible. We have this new reality show now where strangers get married. And
oh, you know, they actually really get married?
Just strangers get married.
Wow. And then they
Next
film it. Cause...
celebrities getting married and celebrities washing their cats.
So when the strangers get married, isn't part of marriage like consummation?
Do you know what? Maybe.
I mean...
I don't know what happened.
I mean, are we going there now? I mean, is that the next thing?
As all I read was that strangers get married and then it didn't work out. Gotcha. So, spoiler alert, it didn't work out.
We actually had a show here called Wife Swap.
Oh, I love Wife Swap. that's one that your version was much better than the British version. That used to be my mum and I, our Wednesday nights would be Wife Swap and pizza.
But look at what these shows, look at what we're also producing. We, you know.
Oh, that was brilliant, Wife Swap.
You had what's her name? You have a lot of redneck Southerners.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like this.
Yeah, we get Honey Boo Boo over here.
Yeah, Honey Boo Boo, exactly. The tragedy that comes out of that. You know, they're sort of exploiting these very, you know, I think maybe morally weakened people.
Maybe. Yeah, I see that. It's like the British are entertained by America and America entertained by Southern states.
Yes, yeah.
Because I've never actually watched Honey Boo Boo.
Me,
but I caught like an episode of things like this 19 Kids and Counting you have. And
yeah, exactly.
There was one about
that's the one
wife,
now.
Four wives. And...
with this guy who just got, you know, for molesting, you know, so they just canceled that show. I can't think of their name. The Duggards? The Duggards, is that it?
Yeah, the Duggards.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, like... So these our TV networks are exploiting these socially inept people.
Yes, hey. Which is why we need to make our independent films on inept people.
Yeah, but if you ever get a chance to see Impractical Jokers, the good thing is everything is sort of on them. It's four guys who compete to sort of, I guess, kind of humiliate themselves. And
like Jackass.
Yeah, but much softer. It's funny. It's what I love about it is it's the only show that all four of us in this house can watch, and everyone loves it.
See, that's nice when you have like a family show.
Yeah.
That was wife swap for us.
What does that say about your family?
I don't know. I'm embarrassed. But I'll redeem it by saying I like Flash Gordon again.
Woo! Yes.
Yeah.
Well, I love Flash Gordon. I love Queen. So you're also going to meet Roger Taylor, one of the greatest drummers in rock and roll, maybe.
Do you know what? He could be. It's always the singer, isn't it? And maybe the lead guitarist that gets the notoriety in bands. But
Roger Taylor was an awesome singer. All the highs were him.
Mm. He is someone that I would love to interview. He really would be.
Oh God!
And we hope to.
I'm going to be so jelly.
Jelly, well gel. That's what we say here.
What do you say?
Well gel.
Okay, talk to me about how Fanny became Fanny. How our Fannies became completely the opposite.
Do you know what? I have no idea. I have no idea, but you do say funny other words because our jam is your jelly. So I was always confused why you had jelly and peanut butter sandwiches because our jelly is your jello. So it didn't make sense to me the way you had this like wobbly dessert with peanut butter.
Well, that's like crisps on a sandwich. That's the crisps chips thing here.
Yes.
As fries and chips is what we do.
Yeah, we're crisps. So
crisps come in a bag, right?
Our crisps come in bags, yes. Yeah.
Our chips come in bags. Your chips are fries.
Our chips are fries.
Yes.
And we have fries in McDonald's. We still, like, I don't know what it is about going into McDonald's. I'll have fries with that, please.
Ah, they stick with the American.
It's like the only way.
Do you get a quarter pounder or Royale with cheese?
Is this a Pulp Fiction thing?
Yeah.
I was always the fish or the chicken.
Oh, so you never got a quarter pounder.
No. I feel like this is leading into some inside joke that I don't understand.
No, the metric system, because in France, it's not even a joke. It's just
from
little
Pulp Fiction.
Yeah, it's the ironic point that, you know, in the metric system, there's no fucking quarter pound.
But
so
wasn't there a thing I heard that in America, you didn't call them French fries anymore? They were called freedom fries?
That was
Is that a rumor?
It wasn't a rumor. That was, you know, this insanity, you know, after, you know, post 9/11, you know, the right wing George Bushyism.
Right.
You know, it was a lot of crazy insanity. But no, you are not incorrect. And if you'll still walk into a diner and see freedom fries on the menu.
But it just doesn't. Like, but what did France have to do? Like, France didn't really do anything.
Oh, no shit.
Lately.
Americans hate France because if it's a political trick.
But didn't they give you the Statue of Liberty?
No, here's the way it works. The political right has convinced most of Americans that France sucks. Because if we found out how good they had it, we'd want it here.
Do you know what? They have an amazing lifestyle.
They
just drink wine all day and eat cheese.
Yeah, I mean, they have a social infrastructure.
Yeah.
And I love the fact that in France, the politicians fear the people.
Yes, that's because the people are really kind of gung-ho.
Yeah.
Even I'm a little scared of the French sometimes.
God bless them.
Do you know what? I have to say, though, last time I went to Paris, they were so lovely. I went into this bar and we were chatting to people and I bought them a drink, like wine. And they said, you know what? I won't do the accent. They said, in my country, if you buy me a drink, I'll buy you a bottle. And they bought us a bottle of wine. They happened to work at the theater nearby, so they snuck us in the back. We watched Sister Act in French. I had no clue what was going on. They brought us back, bought us oysters, brought us more drinks, brought their friends round. I didn't spend a penny apart from that one glass. They were so lovely.
So
I think you should call them French fries again.
I still call them French fries. Most people call them French fries.
Or
they're
just
not even
fries.
French. Aren't they Dutch? Or Belgium in origin?
Fritz. Yeah, maybe. I tell you, the best place to ever get pommes frites is Amsterdam because they lather on the mayonnaise and the ketchup. And you get them in the little cones.
For a lot of my life, I wanted to go to Amsterdam. Now, we don't really need to anymore. We can just go to Colorado.
Yeah, that's true. Amsterdam also has great apple pie. So if Colorado has that, then you have a very valid point.
And they have prostitutes, too. They don't have those in Colorado. Or if they do, they're not in a reaper barn or whatever.
Yeah. Well, maybe you'll find women you don't have to pay for in Colorado.
No, that's true.
Just some drunk ones. I don't know where this conversation
or
is.
Or high. Yeah, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Have you listened to the show?
Yeah.
Kevin sound Smith. Like you have.
Kevin Smith's been to Amsterdam. That's how to link it back.
There you go.
Yeah. No, that's wonderful.
This is so spontaneous, and I feel like we've clicked up here and we're kindred spirits. And
yep. There's some pubs we can visit when you come over.
That'd be great.
And if I get a Jersey. That's such a. I've only seen Jersey Shore. Actually, I was a really big fan. So I don't want to judge the whole state on a show.
So did you travel with your camera person when you came?
We literally just flew into Laredo for about 4 days mm-hmm. and flew out. And being tight budget, our producer was the camera person, yeah, two cameras, and I did sound. Yeah, right. Well, I mean, where we're at, it's that my boyfriend's actually the producer, Ash. So it's handy that we both go, but he's just been so good doing the filming. I would love to have a camera operator. Like, and do it. How stupid does that sound? I would love to have a camera operator to film my documentary. But I genuinely would love to just have, you know, and do. I don't want to ask people to do it for free, but we would like at least a small crew
that
we can afford. So he can do his job, I can do my job, and we actually have someone that does this for a living rather than, you know.
But it also speaks to the value of the idea that you're able to get so many people involved.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I've had emails from people in America saying, you know, if you want anyone to come and help out on shoots, if you want to do post sound, so it has been really amazing.
Isn't it? It's amazing.
Yeah, friends in Ireland have been saying if you want to post house to do stuff. I've got people doing that cool Life After Flash graphic. I don't know if you've watched the video in the Indiegogo, the trailer.
I haven't even opened up your campaign yet.
Open it up and watch the teaser. I'm so excited about the teaser. But he did this really cool graphic for free because he just loves the film. But you'll see what we shot in Laredo. There's a bit of melody in there. We put in Richard's interview. You'll see Trevor Butterfield. I think he's in this trailer. But yeah, it's cool. I'd like to know what you think of it.
Oh God, I'm already excited now.
Yay! Yeah, to email me and tell me what you think.
This is so cool. This is such a cool little thing. This is another. You were talking before about inspiration, I think, and you were like, you know, you get these ideas, you don't know whether you should do it or not.
Just do it.
Yeah, well, I agree. Yeah, we talk a lot on the show about, because podcasting is a very strange endeavor in that when you tell your friends that you're doing it, they look at you like you've got plague. Like, why would you want to do that?
Yeah, why would you waste your time?
They don't understand it. They don't get it. And there is a bit of that, well, if anybody can do it, well, where's the value in it?
Yeah.
And they sort of dismiss it before it even starts. One, not everyone is doing it. Two, everyone who does it isn't going to be good at it.
Yeah.
You know, there are 10,000 reasons just to do it.
Exactly. And it depends what you're doing it for. If you're doing it for you, then if you have like three really, really passionate listeners and you just enjoy it, what does it matter if you have three or 3,000 or 300,000? And it is. And, you know, there are people that kind of just sit and maybe find it difficult to make an idea into reality or, you know, find the motivation for whatever reason. But, you know, everyone's responsible for their own lives and what they achieve. And, you know, I just think it seems silly to waste it, even if it's a small idea or you think it's silly.
Yeah. Yeah. Like a stupid Kevin Smith podcast.
Like a stupid Kevin Smith podcast. Or a stupid Flash Gordon film.
Yeah. You could do a Flash Gordon podcast after the film. Well, the good thing about why podcasting is great, unlike movies, it's an instant medium. You know what I mean?
Yes.
You do it, you record it, it's done, you feel satisfied, you feel creative, and you can move on. So.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's great for opinions and talking and,
you
know, we have everything now with Twitter and Instagram and selfies and Snapchat and everything. Like, everyone just wants it quick.
Yes.
So, yeah, it's good.
Well, I appreciate you giving me your time. I definitely want to keep tabs on this film.
Yeah, for sure. We'll have a look at the trailer. I want to know what you think of it.
All right, well, I'll email you after.
Do it. I'm excited.
And Ted 2. All
right. And he signed up for Ted 3.
Ooh, they're making a Ted 3?
Apparently.
I'm hearing things.
Yeah.
I'm hearing, you know.
Straight from the horse's mouth.
See, but, that, you know, that's like Kevin's movies. People say box office disappointment. They don't get it. Like, that will still have legs.
Fans are a totally different league to the money. I mean, studios say films flop if they make five times as much. So they don't have to pay people the profit, you know.
Yeah.
It's a dodgy business. It really is a shame that it got involved in the whole filmmaking thing in the first place.
So, I don't know about you. My motivation really is telling the story. You know, I'm not thinking of, you know, it's going to cost me money, I know, but it's all right. But the only benefit I can see from it that I will appreciate is it'll feed back to the podcast.
Yeah, and that's how it should be. I think people make the mistake of doing things because they think it'll make them rich rather than what they enjoy, and then they don't have the passion to keep it going, and then they realize it won't make the money because they don't have the, you know, you've got to put a lot of work into doing these things.
God, yes.
I mean, geez, yeah. We started doing this. It was last October that we had the call with Sam.
Wow.
So, you know, it's a slog.
So you're coming up on a year, almost.
It's coming up on a year, yeah. So we're probably going to hopefully come out maybe September.
Wow.
He's got San Antonio Comic-Con, which we'd like to film. We need to get up to Chicago for Alex Ross because he's supposedly agreed to an interview.
I meant to ask you about Alex Ross this whole time. I've been
he's apparently said yes to an interview, but, you know, I don't take these things for granted until
he's huge
they've actually happened.
You've seen his work, I assume.
Of course, I've seen his work.
Well, you saw but have you seen anything other than Flash? Are you a comic person?
I have seen on his website.
Yeah,
but to be honest, I didn't know of him until Flash.
Oh, it's amazing stuff.
To be fair,
amazing stuff. He does more covers now.
Yeah, I saw some things. They look amazing.
Yeah.
But yeah, check out the trailer, and I'd love to see, know what you think.
Oh, I can't. I will let you know immediately. I'll email you.
Yeah, how exciting!
Yeah.
Thank you so much for getting in contact. I really do appreciate it.
I'm glad we can make this happen. That's how I know it was meant to be.
Yeah. Well, good luck with it all.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I'll keep tabs on your Indiegogo.
And you too.
Yeah, thank you. Cool beans.
All right, thanks for coming on.
Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, it was great. And there you go. My interview with Lisa Downs.
Life after Flash.
There you go. So go help her out. Throw her some money. Throw us some money. Throw everybody some money.
He's still, like, pretty sexy, too. He still is.
Yes.
Go well, Flash.
I still love that movie.
Yeah,
I know people think it's campy. And
yeah, but that's the joy of it.
It's got such a great vibe. The whole thing is fun. To me, it's a Star Wars movie. Hmm. It's in the same milieu of like touchstones of my youth. You know, things. Raiders is there too. Dune is in there. But Dune came much later. And Dune influence, like there's a touch. There's a touch
there's
point.
There's a touch between Flash and Dune.
And Dune. And so there you go. I was very glad to land that interview. I'm very excited about that project. I know I will be supporting it. I guess now, geez, the show is so packed. As if you haven't had enough, folks. We got to, I won't go hard sell. I won't go long talk. This week, here it is. At Tesdy Groupies, pick of the week.
That Man on Fat Man presents. At Tesdy Groupies. Tell 'em Steve Dave. Pick of the week.
Hi, and welcome to the TSD Pick of the Week. Lots of things happen during a TSD episode. Sometimes things start in a place, and by the time the show ends, things have gone to so many other different places and touched so many unexpected topics. But that is one of the charms of the show. Expect the unexpected. There is no format, so everything is possible. And that may be also what makes TSD so hard to explain to other people. But one thing is for sure, there is always at least one thing that makes every episode memorable, and usually many more. And some episodes are remembered for those moments. And this episode is definitely one of those. And you will know as soon as I tell you that this week's pick is TSD 59, Right Said Ming. The episode starts with Q giving up his TSD tech guide job Then the guys go on to do something they do amazingly and that really works out every time, commenting on another show. After Min complains on Bugnuts that TSD is running late, the guys comment on clips of that Bugnuts episode done with Sandy Jeff. They comment on the talk heard about baseball, hot women, including Amanda Bynes, before Bri plays the montage he's done with all the times Min says right in that same episode. Immediately, Q asks if Felicity could set it to house music. After this, Walt tells of his chance to be a hero, but how it just went away. Q brings up that his buddy, Chris Lodondo, has written a comic book called Constellation Park, and Walt offers to sell it in the stash. Finally, Walt has a choice of games to play, and the chosen one is Back Issue Bank, where the rest of the guys have to find out which one of these comic books has never been published. And be sure to hang out after the Tell 'em Steve Dane shoutout for an awesome replay. So, I hope you re-listen to it, I hope you enjoy it, and you're all the way.
And there's Miss Groupie's pick of the week. I got to hand it to her. She's pulling some interesting ones.
She is.
A couple weeks back, she pulled a S'morning Show. I almost cringed.
Did she really?
Yeah. I was like, oh, S'morning Show.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but it was a good one. She always picks good ones. She knows what she's doing. We bust on the S'morning Show. Actually, the S'morning Show is great. Mark Costello, good time fellow, really brightens that up when he's on.
He really does.
Yeah.
I miss him.
He's a good guy. He has wished us all, he's given us good luck, and he was one of the first guys to be like a cheerleader. We've had some very nice conversations. I don't know how you could say that without
he's just easy to talk to, and he's...
Yeah, and without being like, ugh. So, yeah. Oh, my God. This show is so long now. What's left? I don't think anything.
You're smart, and you're good.
Well, we should probably plug the movie one more time. Bother everybody.
I don't know the link like you do.
Just go to ThatManOnFatMan.com and look for our Indiegogo campaign link. It'll be on the sidebar on the right of your screen. If not, go to What'sApodcastMovie.com.
And it's right there.
It's there as well. Yep.
And so if you go to Indiegogo and
type
you
in
put
what's
in
a
What's a
Podcast
Movie. Or no,
a documentary film is really the whole name.
What's
but if
podcast?
You type in What's a Podcast,
and
it'll come up.
It'll come up.
So there you go.
If you really want to find it, you'll find it.
Yes. Don't worry, folks. There'll only be one more show of us with the hardcore begging and bothering everybody.
Thank you for tolerating us.
Yes. The surest way to get rid of us is to give. To get rid of us begging is to help us out. All right, folks. You've hung in this long. We'll dismiss the class. We thank you guys for listening. We hope you enjoyed this show. And if you are listening, we know you're smart and good.
Bye, guys.
Take care.
get him, that man.
This is by Queen. This is called Dragon Attack.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for coming out.